Hello, Don, what is the problem? Hello,
actually, sir, we are waiting for head, sir. Head, sir, didn't join us.
Okay.
Thank you. I request everyone to mute the mic, and I request the teachers to kindly switch on the videos so that we may start the event now. We are ready and we may start the event now. Sir, please. PK Singh sir, aapka video nahi aa raha sir, please.
Is it okay now? Is it okay now? Hello.
Sir, aapka awaaz aa raha hai. Sir, aapka awaaz aa raha hai. Aapka video shayad off hai. Usko yes sir. Yes sir. Sir, Raju sir, aap apna video please on kar lijiye. Please. Shall we start? Soham Pranay, everyone.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. You can start the program because BP Singh sir having some problem issues in downloading this app. So I think we should start our webinar.
Okay. So again. So I request every one of my team members and dear participants, please mute your mic and we'll be starting now.
Okay.
Good morning to all. I feel very happy and privileged to welcome you all to this event in my capacity as Vice President of BHU Geoscience Student Chapter of AAPG. This event, URVI, an interactive and exciting geologic milieu, has been designed by AAPG BHU by the support of our teachers to help every student in his or her studies during these hard times of pandemic. Our university is renowned across the globe for classroom teaching practice. Our alumni often headed the esteemed top-notch companies in the field of geology. It is our tradition in BHU to start any event by remembering Baba Vishwanath and our founder. Hence, we shall do this task first before proceeding further in this event. Soham, kindly start the video since we are having this online. Soham, the audio is not coming. Kindly see to that.
Shom, restart the video one time.
Start the video and the audio is not coming. Sir is a well-known figure in the field of coal and organic technology. Sir has been kind of possessing many international awards like NM Chatterjee Award 2018, Shubhrata Ghosh Coal Petrology Award 2015, and many more. His contribution to the geology community is incredible, with more than hundreds of papers in peer-reviewed international and national journals of repute and in many Indian pages. He is an epitome of many rare qualities that students seek. Sir, it's an honor for us to have you with us today. Sir, kindly bless us with your blissful words. Sir, please.
Hello.
Can you hear me?
Sir, hi. Yes, sir.
Our head sir has also joined now. And our faculty member, Professor Jokhan Ram sir, has also joined.
Dear PK Singh sir, kindly start your talk. We are waiting to get blessed by your blissful words.
So shall I speak? Okay.
Yes, sir.
So respected head of the department, respected Professor Jokhan Ram sir, colleagues, friends, and my dear students of the department, at its minimum, our students are organizing this APG chapter in this Banas Hindu University. This is a fantastic job by our students, and I congratulate you all. I was looking into the schedule of the webinar event, and I'm happy to see that my young and dynamic faculty members are actively participating and delivering a series of lectures here. I want to make one suggestion here that I think the lectures are of 1 hour time. So I request you, if it is possible, I request you to take 10 or 15 minutes of last part of this lecture and make it an interactive section. This session will be highly beneficial for our students. And I think the rest is all you have to do. And you are doing just fantastic work. And I wish a grand success to this webinar APG chapter. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your kind and graceful words. We are blessed to have you with us. And sir, to add to your suggestion, we are very happy to have your suggestion. But to add to that, we have planned a half an hour session just after every talk for the participants to question the teachers and clear their doubts. It will be over the telegram.
Okay, then it's all right.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. We are honored and blessed to have you with us today. Moving on further in this event, now I would like to welcome our head of the department, Professor BP Singh, sir, to share some of his words of inspiration. Sir has been one of the most proficient teachers and a very active researcher in the field of sedimentology. Sir has several scores of research publications to his credit in the reputed international and national journals. He is not only very active members of several geologic societies, but is an institution to many living qualities and has been interest in teaching, has keen interest in teaching and upbringing students in the best way possible. Dear sir, I request you to kindly bless us with your kind words. Sir. Dear head sir. I think there is some network issue. Sir is unable. Hope he joins soon.
I request
all the participants to move first.
Any participant making disturbances, we shall remove them from the list.
Don, kindly unmute yourself.
Has headset joined? Soham? Atul?
Yes. Yes, sir. Yes, Don, I can hear you.
No, has headset joined? Because headset has...
Hansen has joined, but he is facing some issue with his microphone and all, I guess.
So,
we shall be waiting for more 5 minutes.
So, shall we move further?
Yes, we can.
Yes, sir, you can. Rams.
So, since our headset is seeing some problems with his microphone, he'll be joined. Taking this event further, I would like to ask our own teacher, who is the inner strength of the student chapter of AAPG BHU, Professor Ram, to please share with us some of his kind words. Sir has served as a director of KDMIP ONGC. He is a petroleum geologist of international repute. Sir, please bless us with your kind words. Yes,
Hello. Yes. Good morning to you all.
Good morning. Yes, sir.
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank
yes,
you.
Yes, sir.
It's my pleasure.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank
yes,
you.
Yes, sir.
It's my pleasure to have you
sir.
All together connected. And I'm very... Hello.
Sir, kindly Hello? On your video. Sir, kindly on your video.
It's on. Okay.
Okay, sir. Now you are visible.
Okay, good. So I welcome you all to this webinar at a time which I consider is most opportune by default because the circumstances that we are in, particularly on account of the COVID-19. So let's use the best of the situation we are in. Friends, I I appreciate the role played by the current body, because they are still in the transition for the APG Institute chapter. And the transformation has also been, the technical challenge has also been this zone itself, transition zone itself. And they have done to organize this webinar, which is very interesting and very nice. Friend, we all grow, the society grows, civilizations grow, only by knowledge. And knowledge is where you seek. Sometimes you experience by observations, and sometimes you also take advantage of the other's knowledge by sharing, by spreading the knowledge. And so this is the message which passes on from one generation to another. And what we need is a resource person. Resource person is a must, because otherwise, if there are no inbreeding, then we are two, three persons only talking among themselves. So it is only inbreeding. Knowledge doesn't go beyond that. So it is a very good thing to interact with a larger community. And we are blessed by having a large community of geoscientists, particularly from BHU geology itself, which are at different positions, different organizations, different institutions. And so first thing, a logical thing would be to tap this expertise, knowledge from our own alumni. And not restricted to that only, but wherever it is possible, but that can be the starting point. And I think students have an APG student chapter have done that. So let's benefit from their experience, their knowledge, because this is not the classroom teaching, it is something beyond that. And I understand that very diversified panel of speakers, and then it will be taking specialization in different areas, and which is the most important thing. Otherwise, it's not possible to lay hands on so many experts at one time. So with this, I only congratulate these students for having done it. And secondly, I wish and I hope that the webinar will grant success, and the students who are dwelling in their houses, not going to colleges and institutes and classes, will benefit tremendously and upgrade their skills. This is the best way of how to try the best of our time and such a scenario. Thank you very much.
I extend a really vote of thanks to this. Hello. Hello, okay. Thank you, sir. Today we had an opportunity to hear you, and this will encourage us in our future events. Thank you. Thank you, sir. To extend this further, I pass the mic to Don.
Thank you, Aparna. Having heard such marvelous speakers and teachers of one of their kind, I shall ask my organizer friend, Soham Sri, has BP Singh sir joined so that we may be having opportunity to hear.
Yes, BP Singh sir is ready. You can start it.
I would like to welcome our own head of the department, Mr. BP Singh sir, to share some of his words of inspiration. Sir has been one of the most prolific, proficient teachers and a very active researcher in the field of sedimentology. Sir has several scores of research publications to his credit in reputed international and national journals. He is not only active members of several geologic societies, but is an institution of many living qualities and has keen interest in teaching and upbringing students in the best way possible. Dear sir, I request you to kindly bless us with your kind words. Sir, BP Singh sir, please. Sir, kindly unmute yourself and... I think again he is facing some problem.
Now we have to move further.
Okay. Now, since we are quite late, that is, we should have started our session by 10:30 with fundamentals of remote sensing, but it's already been 10:41. So, moving straight forward to our session. Now, introduce our first speaker of today's session, Dr. Ashwani Raju, sir. Sir, we are profusely elated to have you amongst us today. Not to lose many more minutes in discussion, but can never dare to skip your introduction to our audience. Professional in the field of sensing, sir, holds several international and national publications in highly indexed journals. And to his credit, he is one of those fortunate persons to get recognized by GSI as a geologist. Sir, with all your permission, kindly, can we start our lecture, sir? It's all to you, Ashwani Raju, sir.
I request all the participants not to switch on their video or mic in between the class. Anyone not following the rules shall be removed from the meeting. I repeat. Anyone not following the rules shall be removed from the meeting. I request Mr. Uday to please switch off your video. Otherwise, we shall remove from you. Sir, please unmute your mic. Sir, your mic is muted.
Okay. I should share the slide or? Now, is it visible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
You are visible.
Yes, sir. Your screen is visible now. Now you can start your lecture.
Okay. The PowerPoint presentation is visible or not?
Sir, visible. It is visible, sir.
Okay. I should start.
Yes.
Okay. Sir, it's visible.
Okay. Thank you, everyone. Respected seniors, colleagues, friends, and dear students. A very good morning to everyone. Hope all of you are fit and fine at your home. So usually we take approximately 12 to 15 sessions to complete the remote sensing course part in our regular semester session. But it's been very difficult to complete all these things in just 4 hours. So what I will do, I'll try to make you comfortable and familiarize with the terminology and the theoretical portion of the concept of the remote sensing. So in case if you have any question, you can ask anytime. So I think without any wasting further time, I should start. Okay, should I start?
Yes, sir, you can start now.
Yes.
Okay. So the topic of presentation is basics of remote sensing. So first of all, make it very clear that remote sensing is not a subject, right? It is basically a tool or a technique by which we can get information about certain thing without having a physical contact with it, right? And remote sensing is basically made up of two words. One is remote and another one is sensing. So remote means any distant object. If we talk about any far being object or any distant object, that is called as a remote, right? Which occur at a certain distance from us. And sensing means to sense something, to get the information about something. So overall, remote sensing is a tool or a terminology by which we can get the information about certain. So how it will operate? The concept of remote sensing is very much in our body. We have different type of sensory organs. For example, we have skin, tongue, and eyes. But the eyes are most prominent one because it gives you the opportunity or it provides you a thing which by which you can directly observe or get the information about anything. And the ultimate source of energy for everything is sun. So what happens in the visual system that sun radiation is illuminated from the sun. It strikes over a particular object, right? And ultimately that object has reflected that particular radiant light to our eyes. So our eyes are sensitive, printed over the retina of our eye in an inverse manner. So the sensing, we need to talk about the electromagnetic radiation, and we should also discuss about the property of electromagnetic radiation, which is particularly a wavelength. So wavelength is nothing but it is a combination of the ratio composition of the velocity and the frequency of a particular wave. We all know that about Planck's particle theory. We said that the radiation which is illuminated from the sun is come to the earth or any other part in a discrete packet. So we receive a radiation in a form of a discrete packets, right? So if overall we can see the electromagnetic spectrum, something look like this, right? So it has the shorter wavelength region, right? It goes up to the longer wavelength region, and further it is divided or classified into the certain different type of wavelength region. Nomenclature of which are the gamma rays, X-rays, ultraviolet, visible region, infrared, microwave, right? Hello, am I audible to everyone?
Yes, sir.
Yes, we are audible to everyone. Audible.
But, sir, your slides are not changing, sir. Actually, you are trying to slide change.
No, I am changing, but maybe there is a network issue. Because of that, it will take a little bit of time to change, right? So in case any problem, you can just raise your hand or just ask me, interrupt me anyway, okay? So now, electromagnetic spectrum slide is visible?
No, sir. No, not yet, sir.
No, sir. Sir, no, sir.
It's on first slide.
Now what happened? Now it is visible or not?
Yes, sir. Now it is visible, sir.
And right.
Right?
Yes.
So in case any problem, you interrupt.
Yes, sir.
So the different region of the wavelength of the electromagnetic spectrum has a different kind of application, right? For example, your radio waves can be used for the communication or the broadcasting purposes. Microwave are used for the radar related purposes or for the military surveillance kind of things. Your visible rays or the information is particularly used for monitoring of the geological phenomena or natural hazard or these kind of things. Your infrared has a different sort of application. So every region of the electromagnetic spectrum has a certain application. And the technique of remote sensing is based on our bias. That is depend upon us. What we want, we can do in a remote sensing, right? So going to the principal division of the electromagnetic, familiarize ourselves with the range of the electromagnetic spectrum. So ultraviolet region, gamma rays or X-rays are particularly have no use in the field of geological purposes. These are particularly used for the medical purposes or in the laboratory. Hello.
Yes, sir. Sir, there is no problem, sir.
So we have the electromagnetic spectrum. For the remote sensing purposes, they start with the ultraviolet region, which is ranged from 0.3 micrometer to 0.4 micrometer. But the problem is because this ultraviolet region lie in a very short length region of the electromagnetic spectrum, because of that, scattering is very much high due to the atmospheric phenomena. And because of that reason, we cannot able to use this ultraviolet region in the remote sensing. So what region we use actually are the visible spectrum, basically for our mapping purposes, for the geological purposes or anything, we use the visible region of the spectrum, right? So we all know that visible region of the spectrum is divided into the 7 part, starting from the violet to red, or going toward the infrared region of the spectrum. And this is basically the white light, which you cannot see, but for the most of the purpose, we use this particular light. For example, in a visual system, for example, our eye are very much sensitive to the blue region of the video, right? Not toward the higher wavelength region, we have a electromagnetic, we have a infrared region. And infrared region is basically start from 0.7 micrometer to 100 micrometer. This region we cannot see with our eyes, but we can feel it. So whatever the heat or whatever warmness we from the sun or we feel is basically belong to the infrared region of the spectrum. And this region, particularly in the geological field, is used to detect the phenomena which are much, which are temperature related basically. So thermal phenomena are basically detected in the part of the infrared region of the spectrum. Now, microwave region, this is particularly a broader region of the electromagnetic spectrum. And now these days, from I think 2000 or 1990, this particular region is very much now these days are using. So wavelength region of microwave region is basically the and this is potential advantageous because this region of the spectrum has the ability to penetrate the cloud, or it is not affected by any atmospheric phenomena. Right, so that is why now these days people are using this microwave data for lot many purposes, right? And especially in the military surveillance. So radar technique is basically an example of a tool which is operating in a microwave spectrum. Now further forward, we have a radio wave which has a wavelength of particularly more than 1 meter, right? And it is basically the broader part of the spectrum, broader wavelength of the spectrum. This particularly used for the communication and the broadcasting purposes. For example, it used for our communication through our mobile phone or a DTH or a big, right? So,
sir, sorry.
Sorry
to interrupt. Kindly switch on the slideshow so that the picture becomes little bigger.
Yeah, I have already opened the slideshow.
But the participants are
okay. If there is if there is any problem, I can share my slide to you guys, and you can use it. Or you can, they can open anywhere they want. They can share it on, share it to you. Is there
then
any
you problem? Can work in full screen mode.
I am working in full screen mode already.
Okay, sir. Then please continue.
Okay.
Sir, it's so, better to share the PPT in the chat.
What I do, I'll share PPT to Don and in the WhatsApp, and he will give it to you. Is absolutely any problem in that?
No, sir.
No, sir. Please give me some time and I'll share. Maybe the network issue is there, the speed is not too much because of that. Maybe the viewers keep on interacting.
Sir, please continue.
Okay, I have shared the slide to Don and he will give it distributed to the team. Okay. Now it is visible.
It is visible.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So far we have discussed about the electromagnetic spectrum, what is it, and what is the classification of electric spectral region in on the basis of different sort of wavelength region, right, and its application. So now we're going to discuss about what is the basic process of remote sensing, how it will operate. As I said earlier, that it is more or less compatible or similar to the visual system. So we have a source of the energy, which is the sun, that is the ultimate source of energy, from which the radiation are illuminated, and these radiation, before reaching to the target, that is the ground of the earth, it has to interact with the atmosphere. It has to be passed through the atmosphere before reaching to the target. And while this process, before passing, what it do, it actually interact with the particles which occur in the atmosphere. For example, in the ionosphere, we have the different sort of the ionic particles. In the troposphere and stratosphere, we have particles like pollutant material. For example, we have a particulate matter, we have the gases, we have water droplets or the water vapor, we have the ozone layer. So all before reaching the radiation from the sun to the earth, thank you. Yes sir. Okay, so we have a illuminating source, right, from where the radiation has been transmitted to the part of the earth after interaction, and it hit the particular object, and reflected radiation has been again measured by the sensor which are on board over the satellite system or a platform. Once the satellite received it, it again transmit the radiation or the quantized information or energy level to the base station, right? And within the base station, these energy level has been processed in the form of an image and send it to us, and we as a user can use this for any other application we want. All right,
I request all the participants to move.
Yes sir. So once the radiation is illuminated from this part of or the source of the sun, it has to interact. As I said, it has to pass through the various layer of atmosphere, starting from ionosphere and up to it closer to the part of the earth which is troposphere or stratosphere. So it has to be processed or it has to be interacted with the particles of the atmosphere before going to the surface, right? So in ionic spheres we have the ions, in troposphere or stratosphere we have the pollutant particles, we have the droplets of the water, we have the ozone layer, we have the carbon dioxide particle. So what it do, it actually affect the emit these incoming radiation and the outgoing radiations, right? So scientists have proposed interaction system of the electromagnetic radiation. So if we have a emitting source, the radiation from the sun is hit radiation which is illuminated from the source and it is reflected back to the radiation. Another thing is, the second most important thing is, it is the inherent property of a particular object to emit the radiation in a certain wavelength, and these radiation are called as the emitted radiance of the object, right? So not only object reflect the radiation which is coming from the sun, but it also emit the radiation which is depend upon its thermal property, right? How much hot is a particular object, it emit the radiation in a higher wavelength region, right? So during, so whether it could be a reflected radiation or it could be emitted radiation, both the radiation when passing through the atmosphere, they have to interact, or certain part of the radiation is scattered, or certain part of the radiation is absorbed by that process. And this deflection or absorption is basically lead to the error in the images or the quantized energy which is received at the this satellite sensors. Okay, am I visible? Oh, audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this is the interaction graph of a particular how the interaction took place. So we have a illuminating source, right? It hit the object, and certain part of the radiation is absorbed, and certain part of the radiation has been deflected back, right? So it is not always possible that radiation which hit a particular object and that emitted radiance or reflected radiation occur at a particular angle. It could be any angle and depend upon the surface of the particular object. If it is undulating, the reflectance can be occur at any angle, right? Then in the atom particle, particulate matter, ashes, or yes, the gas particle or the cloud particle, they also cause the scattering of a particular radiation. Apart from that, beside the reflectance radiation, we also have the emitted radiation, right? So as I told earlier, it is the inherent property of a particular object to emit the radiation in the particular region of a
video,
right? So sensor not only receive the reflected radiance, also receive the emitted readings. Right. So what sort of scattering we can have? You have the basic idea about in your previous classes. For example, relay scattering. Relay scattering is basically caused by the scattering of the particle in the shorter wavelength region. For example, in the waveguide region, your blue region is maximum scattered, and because of that, the sky will appear blue in color. Right. So this relay scattering is basically deal with the scattering of the shorter wavelength region. So ultraviolet region, which has the very short wavelength, is completely collected or scattered by during the relay processes. Or blue region or the Virgo region is little bit affected by the scattered by the relay scattering. And because of that region, your skies appear blue in the midday period and red in the sunset and during the sunrise. Okay, so far if you have any problem, you can ask any question.
So since
hello sir, sorry to interrupt, but I have not got the slides.
Hello Don, are you listening?
Sir, please ask them to share on that Telegram group.
His microphone, he'll be.
If anybody is listening,
own teacher.
I'll please explain relay scattering once more.
Okay. So relay scattering is basically, it is the phenomena which operate in a shorter wavelength region. Right. For example, in a blue region or in an ultraviolet region or a violet region. Right. So this is basically the shorter wavelength region are completely or partially scattered by the particle which are occur in a atmosphere. Right, so in atmosphere we have an aerosol particle, we have a gaseous particle, we have a cloud. So when a shorter wavelength region, radiation of a shorter wavelength region is hit a particular particle within the atmosphere, is completely scattered or partially scattered. Right, because of that scattering, our eye or our sky is basically appears in a blue color. Right, because it is completely, because blue region is maximum scattered by a particular particle, and that is why our sky is right. This is called the relay scattering, and this is operate basically in a shorter wavelength region. For example, in the ultraviolet region, violet and the blue region.
Please share the with us some
okay.
kind words. Sir, as served as. The director of ADMI OATC is a petroleum geologist.
Hello.
Yes, sir. Yes,
okay. Shall you good to go? Are you running?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So, this is the example of this particular figure is depicting or giving information about the relay scattering. Right. So what we have during the day, we have a sun which is directly above our head, right? So rays from the sun to the target object is the distance between the sun to the target object in that particular is very shorter, right? So the scattering of the blue region is very much possible in a day, particular day time, and that is why during the whole day time sky appear blue in color, because the blue region of the visible spectrum is maximum scattered during the daytime. But during the time of the sunset and the sunrise, what happened, that distance between the sun and the target object is quite much higher.
Hello.
Right. So the time period which is required by the radiation to reach to the target from the sun is quite much high, and during this particular point of time or during this period, all the blue region or the violet or ultraviolet region has been completely scattered, leaving behind only red color, red region. And that is why during the sunset time or sunrise time, this particularly sky is appear in reddish in color. Okay. Now we go to the part of maize scattering. So these maize scattering are basically scattered by the particle which has the same size, almost or nearly same size as respect to the wavelength of a particular radiation. The size in the case of the relay scattering, what happened that the size of the wavelength is much shorter as compared to the size of the particle. However, in case of the maize scattering, we have the almost same size of the wavelength and same size of the particle. For example, pollen, smoke, particulate matter, these are basically of the more or less larger in size and hit by the particular radiation and cause the maize scattering, right? Both relay scattering and maize scattering are basically the part of the selective scattering. Selective, why it is called as a selective scattering? Because only a certain portion or the selected portion of the radiation has been deflected or scattered by these phenomena. Now we come to the part of the non-selective scattering. In case of the non-selective scattering, the size of the particle is quite much higher as compared to the size of the or the wavelength region or the wavelength size of a particular radiation. So size of the particle is quite much higher. For example, in case of the water droplet or in case of the ash particle, so the whole of the wavelength which is strike these particular particles has been scattered equally in all the direction, right? So this is actually caused the non-selective scattering, and that happened basically in the part of the visible region of the spectrum, right? So this is how we have a selective in the remote sensing, and these scattering are basically induce error when we try to analyze the remote sensing images. Okay, now another thing which is a phenomena which is called as the absorption, right? So absorption is nothing but certain particle in the atmosphere actually absorb the radiation which has come from them. So these basically what it do, it absorb the radiation. For example, your particle, water particles or water vapors, carbon dioxide or ozone particles which are present within the atmosphere, they basically absorb the certain portion of the radiation which is coming from the sun, right? So because of this
सर आपका स्लाइड आ ही नहीं रहा है, मतलब पहले जो भी एक दिख रहा था अब एकदम ब्लैक.
अरे मैंने तो तुमको सेंड कर दी, राइट? इन द स्लाइड आपने टेल द पार्ट इज सेंड किया है. हां, अरे सेंड को एवरी पार्टी ने किया. हेलो,
आ गए, आ गए, आ गए.
एक्सक्यूज मी सर, आई एम शेयरिंग योर पीपीटी. When you say next, I shall proceed.
Yeah.
Continuing the next slide. I'm doing that. Yeah.
So right now I'm in this absorption slide. Okay.
Is it visible to all?
Yes. When I said next, you just
Okay, sir.
Alright. Okay, so now currently I am on an absorption slide. Okay.
Okay, sir.
So as I said, absorption is basically a mechanism like it is, for example, we have an illuminating radiation from the sun, and while passing through the atmosphere, it has to interact with the particles. So basically the particle or the objects like carbon dioxide, ozone layer or water vapor, they basically what it do, it absorb a certain portion of the radiation, and it doesn't allow the complete or 100% complete part of the radiation to pass through it. It actually absorbs a certain portion of the radiation in both the process, when the radiation is coming from the sun or it is reflected from the object. In the meantime, it what it do, it actually absorbs a certain portion of the radiation, right? So these
absorption, these scattering is basically induce the error in the processes. Because how much radiation is reflected, it is not completely available or sensed by the particular sensor. All right. Is it okay to everyone?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So go to the next slide. Next slide is a reflection. Okay.
The transformation now, has also been.
The radiation which is illuminated from the sun, which is that actually hit the particular object right over the surface of the earth, and it is reflected back to the sensor, and sensor sense that particular radiation. So reflection could be of two type. One is specular reflection, another one is a diffuse reflection, right? So in case of the specular reflection, whatever angle at which the radiation hit the particular object, it is maintained the same angle while it is transmitted back to the sensor. So the angle of the incident and the angle of reflection is almost the same in case of the specular reflection, right? But it is not happen in the case of the real world environment. In the environment, we always have undulating surface, and because of the undulating surface, we have a diffuse reflection. That means the angle at which the radiation is illuminated from the sun and it hit the object is not always the same with the angle at which it is transmitted back to the sensor. Right? So this is called as a diffuse reflection. So at the sensor, we always receive the diffuse reflection.
Next. Only by knowledge.
Hello, is it okay?
The knowledge is,
yes sir,
where you seek.
Yes sir. Just tell me yes or no. Okay. Now we are on a electromagnetic energy balance relationship. So this relationship clearly said that whatever incident light or the percentage of the reflection
sometimes
is incident,
you also
this is a composite of the reflected energy, absorbed energy, or transmitted. Right.
The other is not.
Now, whatever percentage of the it is completely equal to the absorbed energy, reflected energy, and transmitted
energy. Knowledge.
Right. So this is the electromagnetic energy balance relationship. And whenever this is not the in most of the cases, in every case, this incident energy is not every time equal because of the absorption of the reflected energy during the process of transmission from the surface to the sensor. It has been absorbed at a certain places within the atmosphere, and because of that, whatever sensor receive, it is not completely the same as the incident energy. Okay, next slide. Okay, so it is basically object to emit or reflect the radiation in a particular wavelength, right? It is the inherent property. For example, a rock, for example, we have a gabbro. So gabbro have the reflected radiation or emitted radiation in a particular wavelength region, right? It has certain absorption, or it has a certain wavelength region. It has its own property. Granite has its own property. And this is basically deal with the composition of a particular material. No two object in this world are same, and because of that every radiation which is emitted radiation or reflected radiation by a particular object is also not the same, because the compositional they are different, and therefore they reflect the radiation or they reflect their response in a different wavelength region, right? So this is why no two object in this world are same. And what we do, we use to measure the wavelength region of a different object which is different, and because of that we try to differentiate one object from another, right? So objects in the remote sensing is differentiated from one to another because of their wavelength relationship or their spectral response,
And this spectral response is not same because their internal condition or their atomic structure, the compositional structure is completely different from one another. Okay. Clear so far?
Yes.
In case any problem, you can ask. Hello. Yes, sir. Okay. So far, so clear. If you have any question or any participant have any question, you can just ask.
So what is it signifying in the molecular rotation part of the diagram which you have on the
slide? I am telling that you all know that no two objects in this world are similar, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, in any way, but their spin quantum number is always different. It could be half or minus half, right? So
yes.
Every object which is different has its own property to reflect or emit the radiation in a particular wavelength region. Uski khud ki property hai ki wo kis zone mein ya kis wavelength region mein wo radiation emit karega ya reflect karega. All right.
Okay, sir.
So what we do, we try to measure the radiation or reflectance of it and try to classify our object based on their radiation, because radiated by it is completely different, so objects are naturally from there. So in remote sensing, what we do, we used to, you know, measure the wavelength or spectral or receive or calculate or analyze the spectral response of a particular object. Okay, any other doubt?
Okay, sir, thank you.
Hello, sir.
Hello,
sir. Can you explain diffuse reflection once more?
Okay. In case of the diffuse reflection, what happened that if over the surface of the surface on the surface of the earth, right, we have a different sort of objects. We have the buildings, we have the vegetation land, we have the trees and forest and everything, right? So
yes,
the surface is not smooth, right? So basically, it is undulating. So whenever what happened that radiation is coming or illuminated from the sun, it hit the object and always reflected back. So the angle of incident rays and the angle of reflected rays is not the same. So that is the diffuse reflection, right? That is diffuse.
Yes, sir.
All right. In case, okay, doubt is clear. Your doubt is clear or not?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay. So now, going to the next slide, right? So far we have discussed about the scheme of the remote sensing program, right? We have, for example, we have a sun, or it illuminate the radiation which hit the target and it received by the sensor after the interaction with the atmosphere, and after the from the sensor, these radiation of the energy levels are quantized, and these energy levels are transmitted to the processing stations, and these energy levels are converted into the image form and distributed to the others, and distributed to the us, people like us who use the these remote sensing for different kind of purposes, right? So this is the scheme of the remote sensing. So your data could be downloaded in various format. Now these days, the data are available in the TIFF format or IMG format or whatever. In earlier dates, or for before 1990 or 1980, the data was available in the form of a data tape, right? You have probably seen the audio cassettes long back then. I hope everybody has seen this audio cassettes. Right, so that audio cassettes has a tape, yes, magnetic tape, non-color tape, right?
Yes, sir.
Similar to that, before 1980s or 1985, the data was available in a form of a tape, right? Now these days, data are available in a digital form. but that time data was available in the form of team. Alright. So next slide, if we see the remote sensing platform. So platforms are nothing but you can see the objects or the technical thing over which the sensors are on. Jispe sensor laga hota hai, that is called as a platform, which we called as a satellite or shuttle or aircraft or whatever. So depending upon your purpose, your wristband or your remote sensing could be airborne, right? It could be called as a spaceborne in the case when the satellite is installed in the space, right? It could be called as an airborne if the sensor is installed over a aircraft or a shuttle or a helicopter or a drone, whatever, right? So based on the platform, your remote sensing could be airborne, your remote could be spaceborne, or your remote sensing could be ground based. Now these days people are using drone also. Even India, a lot many people are using drone. Right. So based on their based on the elevation of the platform or the space satellite, it could be spaceborne. If it is the satellite is installed in the space, it is called as a spaceborne. If the sensor is onboard over a satellite, put over a satellite over an aircraft sensor or drone, it is called as a ground based. So far, if you have any question, if you have any.
Yes, sir.
Shall I good? Okay, shall I good to go?
Yes.
Sir, okay, next
question,
sir. Yeah, you can ask.
Sir, can we use remote sensing from ground surface?
No, we can't use from the ground surface. I'll tell you later. For the cartographic mapping, people now these days are using these drones, right? So they have the sensor and the camera installed over the drone, and the drone has the elevation of approximately 150 meter or 200 meter or something, right? So you have probably seen in lot many movies now these days they use the longer shot, and from the elevated portion they use the drone. So drone is basically installed at a height of approximately 150 meter or 200 meter from the ground level. Okay, now what is your question?
Not only that, European Space Agency recently made an laser into the ground atmospheric changes in the Antarctica.
Yes.
So they use LIDAR.
Yes, that is called as a radio sounded data. So whatever data from the atmosphere they want to collect, that is called as a radio sounded data. What they do, they actually installed a shaft or something like that. They put the sensor which detect the data from the atmosphere. So we can do anything, we try to get the information about any object without having a physical contact. Bina kisi ko chhuye hum pata lagate hain uske baare mein. That is, we can install our platform over the surface of the earth to get the information about the sky or the atmosphere, or we can put our platform in the space to get the information about the earth, whatever it may be possible. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
So change the next slide and come to the beginning of remote sensing, which is the aerial photograph, right? It is slide number 25. Okay, so the question arises, if we go to the history of the remote sensing, from where it has started, right? So in earlier days and during the 19th century or later the 19th century, for the purpose of the remote sensing, there were only one option available, which is trying to take the photograph, right? Based on the photograph, you can get the information, right? Photograph is also a technique of the remote sensing. What we do, we click the particular button and we just get the particular figure of or image of a particular object, which is occurring at a certain distance from us, right? So earlier days, during the early part of the 19th century later part of the 19th century, people used to take the photographs, and based on the photograph they try to get the information, depict the information, right? So that was the case of the aerial photography. And now these days
aerial photographs are not very much in use. But certain organization, for example, GSI is quite frequently using these aerial photographs because these aerial photographs has a very good ground resolution. It gives you the very good ground clear image of a particular object, right? So it started way back in 1962 during the Photoshop or this a photo gallery has been organized during the 1962, and from there when the image is published, which is taken by the NADAR from the elevated portion, he took the camera over the balloon and take the photographs. So, and later on this people have used the remote sensing or installed their camera or attached their camera to the kite or the pigeon to get the information or photograph of a particular thing, right? And that happened because in earlier days, during that particular period, it was a time of imperialism, capitalism, a lot of wars were going on. So that photograph or alien photography or remote sensing during that period is particularly used for the military operation or surveillance purposes, right? Nigrani karne ke liye use hone lage. And that has gained various widespread interest during the first war condition, where the people have used it for the military surveillance. Okay. So am I audible to everyone?
Yes, sir.
Yes,
yes,
sir.
Yes.
Come to the yes, slide sir. Number 29. Come to slide number 29, which is history, Kodak, camouflage detection. Okay, come to that slide. So during Second World War time, during 1943, the Kodak, very famous company for making the film or video reel or making the cameras, they have introduced one patent technology which is called as the camouflage detection, right? So camouflage, you all know that what is camouflage? Okay, it is based on a particular object to a certain environment. It is basically adaptation. So what people have do, they have the military facilities, and over that military facility, they hide that facility by pushing the leaves of the plant over there, right? So Kodak had introduced one patent technology which is called as, or introduced a film, or which is called as the IR film or infrared film, which used to give health of a vegetation, and based on the health of a vegetation, they can detect the particular surveillance, or they can detect the particular military facilities over there. So that camouflage detection technique or introduction of the infrared film by the Kodak has gained a widespread interest everywhere. After the Second World War, the things have been completely changed. And photograph that are the manual photograph or interpretation of these manual photographs has been transferred or transmitted to the digital platform after the introduction of the computers. Early days, we have used this photographic technique during the up to the Second World War, and post Second World War, we have used this or shift the interpretation from a manual phenomenon to a digital. Okay, clear so far?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this is the, come to the slide number 30. This is the spectral reflectance. Please mute your microphone. Okay. So come to the slide number 30. This is the spectral vegetation, spectral reflectance curve of a vegetation, right? If you see, we have the x-axis, which is the wavelength, in the y-axis we have the reflectance in the form of percentage, right? So this is the complete spectral response of a vegetation in a complete wavelength region. So you will find that the vegetation or a healthy vegetation has the maximum response in the, or maximum reflectance in the, in approximately around 0.8 region to 1.2 region, right? If you see closely, you'll find that the vegetation has the maximum reflectance in wave 0.8 to 1.2. Okay. Is it visible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Okay. So this reflectance is called as the whole curve is called as a spectral reflectance curve, right? And it is basically a response of the reflected radiation or reflectance against the different in a complete wavelength region, right? So this is also called as a spectral reflectance curve is also called as a spectral signature. This is also called as a spectral signature. We will discuss it about later. Okay. Come to the next slide, which is the example of the infrared.
Sir, in that graph, there was written about cell structure in infrared region.
We will come to that particular point later. When we discuss about the spectral signature, we will discuss this particular graph in detail. Okay. So far, just remember that that is a spectral response region of a particular object, right? It could be the response of a vegetation, you could have the response of a for a rock sample, you can have the response, spectral response, reflectance response of a particular mineral. Whatever may be the case, the graph should be something like this. It could be vary, but it could be something like this. And this is called as a spectral reflectance curve, right? It is also called as a spectral signature or a spectral reflectance curve, and we'll discuss it about later. Okay, so what was the question actually?
I was asking, are able to see the cell structure, then how come from the atmosphere we are able to see the cell structure? Because in the plants, the cells will be stacked one above the other.
This is the spectral response. For example, you have the spectral response, highest spectral response from 0.7 to 1.2 wavelength region. Okay, you can observe that.
Yes, sir.
Okay, that maximum reflected the region of 0.7 to 1.2, right? And that region is called as a near infrared region. So for a healthy vegetation, you can have the maximum reflectance in the near infrared region, and this maximum reflectance is because of the cell structure. We cannot see the cell structure from the sensor, right? This maximum response is because of the cell structure. Us cell ke structure ki wajah se wo maximum response aata hai. Hum cell ka structure nahi dekhte.
Okay, understood. Thank you, sir.
Okay, come to the next slide, which is the example of the infrared region. So if you see in a panchromatic data, which is panchromatic is basically a photograph or an image which is taken in a visible light, 0.35 or 0.3 to 0.7 region. It is a complete range, and within that complete range a photograph has been taken. It is similar to the photograph which we take using our mobile phones, right? We are using the panchromatic data, panchromatic range. So this is the panchromatic range, and this is the infrared film that is introduced by the Kodak, right? On the right side you have the infrared region. So you can see in the red box, you can see that we have a bushes or we have, right? But in panchromatic data it is more or less looks like a homogeneous, but in case of the infrared, when you use the infrared film, you can get the certain information that lighter pixels or lighter color objects are present, and somewhere it is dark color objects are present, right? So the benefit of the infrared film is that it can to get more information rather than using a panchromatic data. Okay, up to this point is clear,
sir? Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Similar to that, you come to the next slide. For example, at infrared region, come to the next slide, you can have a color photograph, right? You can have a color photograph. We see the vegetation land, which is called as a standard film in a natural color composite. It's standard film. For example, we take a photograph in a panchromatic light or in the daylight, it is appear as a similar. For example, but if we use the infrared region, it appears that it gives a certain different type of color. So the use of the film is advantageous in that way that we can observe or we can get them more compared to the standard film or panchromatic data, right? That is why we use the infrared region, or that is why we use the different region of the spectrum, because we want to use or we want to capture more information from a particular scene rather than a standard scene. If you use the standard scene, you can able to differentiate only few objects. But if you use the infrared or the color composite, you can observe the different sort of the object. Right? Clear to this point?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, come to the next slide, which is slide number 30. Yeah, you can ask.
As you see, the hello, sir.
Boliye.
So can you explain about the product advertising?
What is? Please repeat your question.
Hello, sir.
Bataiye.
So can you explain about the product advertisement again?
Okay. In 1943, during the Second World War time, right? There were chaos everywhere. So people want to use the remote sensing technique for the military surveillance, but during that time they used to only take the photographs, right? Photographs, normal photograph, black and white photographs they used to take. So what Kodak has done, Kodak has produced a film which is called as an infrared film. Why it is called as an infrared film? It will be called as an infrared film because it operates in an infrared region, right? So earlier what we used to take this photograph or black and white photograph. So within a black and white photograph, we can't expect the objects. But when we introduce the camouflage or when we introduce the infrared film, the vegetation is used, they able to detect the vegetation, right? Okay, so what happened that they used to cover the facility because they have the military basement and military facilities were there, and they used to cover the military facilities with the bushes or the leaves or the plant, right? So no one able to detect that particular thing. So what Kodak has done, Kodak has introduced the infrared film, right? And in the infrared field, what we have the maximum reflectance of the vegetation. So health of the vegetation is able to detect it. Right, so the things were very clear that what could be the fresh leaf or what could be the, we can able to differentiate between the fresh leaf and we can able to differentiate between the dry leaves. Okay, you understand or should I explain again?
Yes sir, thank you.
Okay. In case if anybody is having any doubt, they can ask.
So in color composite images, we can decide what colors we can give to a particular set of wavelength in IR film.
Yes, we can decide, and that is called as a fast color composite or a color composite. We'll discuss it in the later part of the presentation. Okay, sir, fine, thank you. So now slide number 33, just after the example of the colored photograph of this infrared example of the infrared, just come to the remote sensing. So in, if you go by the definition, for example, you have a book of a seven book of a remote sensing geology by Professor R.P. Gupta sir, and lot many books are of remote sensing are there. So if you go by definition, it is nothing but it is a technique of acquiring the data, processing the data, and interpretation of the data. Your data is nothing but an image, right? Remote sensing is nothing but acquiring, processing, and interpretation of the image to get the information of our use. It is basically user bias. For example, if I want to study the natural hazard, if I want to use the flood,
sir, can you hear me?
Ashwani sir. Don.
Atul, I think unka internet problem hua hai. Just wait for 5 minutes.
Okay. Don, ek baar contact karo sir ko.
Kar le, bas kar le.
Hello.
Yes, sir. You are audible, sir.
Okay. But there is a problem of power cut. So you can change the slide. I can give. I can be the informative. There is absolutely no problem. Okay. Am I audible to everyone?
Yes, sir. You are audible.
Yes, sir. Okay. She was asking something.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. You were asking something. You asked?
Yes, sir. I was asking that for near infrared region, we observe the vegetation with the help of cell structure. Okay. Why not we are using here leaf pigments? Because no. Those vegetations will also be having
Remote sensing has nothing to do with the cell structure or leaf pigment or cellulose content or lignin or whatever, right? Remote sensing has nothing to deal with that, right? We have seen the maximum reflectance response in near infrared region, right?
Okay.
We have seen the maximum response in the near infrared region. When they try to find out why we have the maximum infrared, near infrared response, then they find out that because of the cell structure, this is showing the maximum reflectance, right? So cell structure, leaf pigment, they are showing based on the laboratory experiment. All right. So वो क्यों उसमें दिखाई दे रहा है? वो बाद में पता लगाया गया कि cell structure की वजह से ये problem है या leaf pigment की वजह से problem है. उस वजह से reflectance absorb हो जा रहा है या maximum reflectance show कर रहा है. That information is purely based on the laboratory experiment, but spectral response has been purely because of the remote sensing or derived from the remote sensing technique. Okay, so your pigment or cell structure just give you the information for information purposes. I give you that particular information to you. Why we have the near infrared region, high reflectance in near infrared region? Because of the cell structure. And why we have the absorption visible region? Because of the leaf pigment.
Okay, sir. Okay, thank you, sir.
Okay. So, hello, Atul or Don, any one of you are there?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Bully.
Okay. So, go to the atmosphere on those side.
Change
the slide to atmospheric window.
So, sir, वो कर रहा है थोड़ा मतलब
okay, next. Okay, hello, Don.
Yes, sir.
Okay, I am again joining. There is internet is not now available. There is absolutely no problem. So I try to rejoin the call.
Okay, sir.
Join me again through laptop.
Okay, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir. Is this you, Raju sir?
Hello.
Sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Sir, audible.
Okay. Now change the slide.
Soham, please change the slide.
Slide number, please.
Atmospheric window. Slide number is 34.
Soham.
So far up to the atmospheric window, I hope everything is clear, or if you have any doubt, you can just ask.
Sir, after this session, we have made 15 minutes plan to ask any question or any query any participant has, so that during the session, we may take full time.
Okay, so it's already over 11:30. It's already 12 o'clock. In case you want me to continue, I'll continue.
Please continue. Okay.
Now come to the next slide, which is a sensor system. Now, so far, am I audible?
So far
we have discussed about the electromagnetic region, their response, atmospheric windows, this atmospheric this spectral reflectance curve or the spectral signature, and everything we have discussed, right? So now the ultimate part is basically the sensor system of platform. The ultimate part is the sensor system. We see the sensor system. Our sensor system can be divided into two parts. One is the passive remote sensing sensor system, and another one is the active sensor system, active remote sensing sensor system. Right. The remote sensing uses the passive remote sensing is called as the passive remote sensing, or the remote sensing technique which use the active sensor is called as the active remote sensing. The basic difference between these two sensor system is very simple. In the passive remote sensing, we have the illuminating agent as a sun. Sun is the ultimate source of energy, and we use the reflected radiation of the sun in the passive remote sensor. However, in case of the active sensor or the active remote sensing, we have our own illuminating source, right? So even the satellite also have illuminating source. It emits the radiation and receive the back scattered radiation. So it is called as the active remote sensing. So most of the sensor, for example, your 80% of the sensor now these days are operating at a passive remote sensing sensor. They use the sun as the ultimate source of energy. And in active remote sensing sensor, they use their own illuminating source, which is onboard over a satellite platform, right? So example of the active remote sensing is the microwave remote sensing, where we have the radar sensors, right? So radar do it illuminate radiation and it receive the backscattered radiation. Okay, clear so far?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Come to the next slide. Okay, so if you see, based on the illuminated source, I have already discussed, we have the one active sensor or the passive sensors. So in passive sensors, it's basically use the radiation source from the sunlight, right? Where in case of the active sensor, it uses its own illuminating sources. And for example, your microwave data or your radar system, radar sensors, right? And the advantage of the active sensor over the passive sensor is that when you have your own illuminating agent or own illuminating source, you can use the measurement or collect the information or the images at any point of time in a, within a day. So within a day, you can collect the data. Within the rainy season, you can collect the data, or any season you can collect the data. Whereas in case of the passive sensor, you cannot collect the data in case of the cloud wherever there is a cloud or wherever there is a raining, you cannot collect the data in case of the passive sensor. However, in case of the active sensor, you can easily collect the data despite of its dependency on the day or the season. Okay, come to the next slide. Okay, now, so we have discussed about the sensor system based on its illuminating agent. Now, based on its operation, we can call it as a, based on our operation, we can call it as or classify it in a whisk broom sensor or the push broom sensors, right? So whisk broom, just hold on a second. Okay, so we have a push broom sensor, we have a whisk broom sensor. Okay, so push broom sensors are also called as a along track, and whisk broom sensor are basically called as a across track. Broom, you all know that, right? Broom is a basically a jhadu, nothing more than that, right? So we have a push broom, so push broom means with a forward motion of a platform or a satellite, it used to calculate or collect the data, or the sensor receive the spectral response perpendicular to the flight direction. Come to the next slide. Okay, see the C figure in the left hand side, it shows the operating procedure of the push broom sensor. So if you have see the push broom sensor in the upper part where we have written electronic satellite sensor, so it has the linear sensors arranged in a array fashion. Ek line mein sensor arrange hota hai, right? And with the forward motion of a satellite, it used to collect the data perpendicular to the direction of the flight, right? But the scanning direction, in both the cases, the thing is bit similar. They both collect the data perpendicular to the direction of the flight. But the basic difference between the push broom sensor and the whisk broom sensor is that it is about the scanning line. In push broom sensor, it is scan the longitudinal scanning line parallel to the direction of the flight. Just direction mein satellite move kar raha hai. In the same direction, it is scan the object. Whereas in case of the whisk broom sensor, it has a rotating mirror, right? That rotating mirror has the pendulum like motion or oscillatory motion. So it used to collect the data parallel to the or perpendicular to the direction of the flight, right? So the basic difference, both collect the data perpendicular to the direction of the flight, but the only difference between the push broom sensor and the whisk broom sensor is based on their scanning line. In push broom sensor, it is the surface based on the parallel to the direction of the flight, whereas in case of the whisk broom sensor, it is scan the line or scan the object perpendicular to the direction of the propagation of the flight. Okay, so if you have any doubt based on the push broom sensor or whisk broom sensor, you can ask.
So what is the difference between IFOB and FOB?
Okay, IFOB and FOB are basically same. FOB is basically not same. FOB is the field of view, right? So sensor has the capability to only sense a particular area on the Earth system, right? So the area which is sensed by a particular object or a particular sensor is called as a field of view, FOV, right? That is called as a field of view, or that is also called as a swath. FOV is also called as swath, right? Whereas IFOV is the instantaneous field of view, right? So instantaneous field of view is a particular pinpoint location where the sensor has scanned the particular object, right? And this IFOV is also called as a cell. So we all know that we have an image, and image is made up of building block of elementary unit, which is called a cell. So IFOV is the cell, is particularly a pixel or a cell, which is called as an instantaneous field of view. right? But FOV is the field of view, which is called as the swath. Swath is the area, total area, which is scanned by a particular sensor. We'll discuss about it later. Okay, any more question?
No, sir.
Okay, go to the next slide. Okay, so the question arises that what sort of measurement or what sort of the unit of the radiation, right? Whether it that the reflected radiation or emitted radiation, how these units have been measured or what are the terminology, basic terminology behind it. So the units are basically irradiance or radiance or reflectance, or the data are collected in form of these units, right? So irradiance is basically nothing but a radiant flux operated or radiant flux incident or over a per unit area. Within the area, per square meter of the area, how much radiation has been incident over a particular period of time, that is called as a irradiance, right? Now the radiance is basically the amount of the radiation which is emitted by the object or reflected by the object, right? This is called as the radiation, that is the amount of energy which is radiated or coming out from the earth or a particular object per unit time, per unit area, right? And the unit of your radiance is watt per meter, is radian per meter square. Or, okay, now the another thing which is the reflectance, the another unit is the reflectance. Reflectance is nothing but a ratio of the amount of the energy or the amount of the radiation which is leaving with respect to the amount of the radiation incident over a particular object. And to calculate the reflectance, we need to know certain information about the radiance, the angle of the sun, and the angle of the sun and the distance between the sun to earth and during that particular time, right? So all these information you can get from the metadata file, right? When you download the satellite data, we'll see that how to download the satellite data. When you download the satellite data with the images, you can also got one file, one text file, which is called as a metadata file. So within the metadata file, all the attribute of the collected information has been given. For example, at what particular time this image has been taken, when the images were taken, what was the position of the sun, or what is the angle of the incident, what was the distance between the earth and sun. So all these information are given in the metadata file, right? So information which we get from the remote sensing data is basically now these days in the form of the radiance, and we used to calculate or convert the radiance value to reflectance value by certain mathematical operations. Okay, so units are irradiance, radiance, or reflectance. Irradiance are the nothing but a amount of the radiation which is incident or a particular per meter square. Radiance is the amount of the radiation which is emitted from the particular object, and reflectance is nothing but a ratio of emitted radiance with the reflected radiance with respect to the incident radiation. Right, and all the information which is required to calculate the radiance or reflectance, all these information are given in metadata file, which is come along with the satellite data. Okay, go to the next. Okay, now we are over the spectral signature. Spectral signature we have also already discussed earlier, that spectral signatures are nothing but a spectral response over a complete electromagnetic wavelength region, right? How a particular object has response in a particular region, that is called as a spectral signature. And signature is basically is a very peculiar to everyone. My signature is different from your signature. So that is called as a spectral signature. That means it is a spectral response, and a spectral response is different from of one object is different from another object, right? And that is called as a spectral signature. So based on the spectral signature, different objects over the surface of the earth are recognized differently based on that only, right? So a spectral signature or these can be made from the reflectance curve or emissivity curve. Emissivity is nothing but it is a magnitude of the emission. how much radiation a particular object is emitting, that is called as a emissivity, or it could be a reflective response. So the spectral response of the reflectance or spectral reference of the reflectance response of a emissivity, whatever would be the case, they define the spectral signature of a particular object, and these signature are very much useful to differentiate the different objects. So in remote sensing, basically what we do, we use to identify the spectral signature of a particular object, and based on these spectral signature, we classify our object into the different categories. Okay, so come to the next. Okay, again next. Okay, so a spectral signature, if you see this graph closely, earlier graph we have already discussed, if you see this graph closely, we have a spectral response, a complete spectral response of reflectance in the percentage against the wavelength region, right? So we have a different object. It is also a classical example. We have a different objects. We have a vegetation. We have a dry soil. We have a wet soil. We have a lake water, clear water, or we have a turbid river water, right? So a spectral response of these objects have been calculated. And if you see that all these different objects have a different spectral response, right? For example, your vegetation has the absorption in the visible region, whereas you in dry soil, you have the absorption in the approximately 1.9 micrometer wavelength. Similarly, if you see the clear water and turbid water, clear water is clearly absorbed, or the spectral reflectance curve of the clear water doesn't go behind the 0.8 micrometer. Whereas in case of the turbid water, the spectral response has gone far up to the 1.0 micrometer, right? And this is because turbid water has the particulate matter or suspended solid and everything, right? So these solids material present is actually reflect their response also. So because of their response, the turbid water has a response which is goes up to the 0.9 to 1 micrometer, whereas a clear water, it doesn't have any particles, so that it is completely, the radiation is completely absorbed after 0.8 micrometer, right? So similarly, you can see wet soil and dry soil also have a different spectral response. So every object over the surface of the earth has the different spectral response. In earth, if we talk about the in terms of geology, we approximately 4,500 known mineral occurrences are find out from the surface of the earth, right? Approximately 4,500 minerals have been recognized. So Jet Propulsion Laboratory of the NASA has measured the complete spectral signature or the spectral response of 4,500 minerals and put these spectral response in one software which is called as ENVI, right? So the name of the software is ENVI. So if you want to do some mineral mapping or you want to do some lithological mapping, you can match your spectral reflectance, your observed reflectance with respect to the laboratory observed reflectance, right? So this is how we differentiate the different objects. So this is the advanced level of remote sensing. We'll discuss it when discuss about the hyperspectral remote sensing. So far, I hope everything is clear about the spectral signature. If you have any doubt, you can ask.
Sir, can you explain the difference between dry soil and wet soil a bit again?
Yeah.
The spectral signature about.
Dry soil, if you go with the dry soil, it has certain mineral content, right? So if you take the spectra, complete spectra of the dry soil, you can see there is a complete spectral response. And only you can see the absorption in the little bit of absorption in the 1.4 micrometer region and 1.9 micrometer region, right? But if the soil is wet, that it also has the content of the moisture. And we all know that moisture content, the response of the water content doesn't go beyond the 0.8 or 1 micrometer. Then the spectra of the wet soil is a little bit lower because the water which is presented within the wet soil actually absorbs the certain portion of the radiation. Right, and that is why your dry soil and wet soil follow the more or less same pattern, but the absorption region in 1.4 micrometer and 1.9 micrometer is quite higher in case of the wet soil, and that happens because of the presence of water molecule within the wet soil. Okay, clear?
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Okay, come to the next slide, which is color composite. Okay, so we all know that our primary color in our basic classes, we all know that our primary color is basically red, green, and blue. We all know that, right? And if we want to see anything in color or color in a color, then we have to see these things in a combination of red, blue, and green color. Okay, then only we can able to differentiate the color of the different object. So in a multispectral image means the spectras are or images are collected in a different wavelength region. If you pick the single images, which is also called as band 1 or band 2 or band 3, so wavelength region, your channel or your band, all these are the similar terminology. So if we collect the single photograph in a particular wavelength region, which is for example called as a band 1, it appears in gray color, right? So single response is always appear in a gray, black and white color or a gray tone, right? And if we want to see these things in color, the information in color, then we have to make certain combination, of a band, three combination of a band in terms of blue, green, or red, green, or blue. Okay. So this is called as a FCC, which is called as a, so color composite is nothing but is it is a combination of any three gray color band, grayscale images or single wavelength images, right? So color composite is a combination of any band. So for example, in a Landsat actually collect the data, Landsat 7 actually collect the data or the spectral response in 7 wavelength region or 7 band. So each band give a gray color. And if we want to see the things in color, what we have to do, we have to made a certain combination of the bands in term of red, green, or blue. We have to made any three band combination to see these things in color. And why we want to see the things in color? Because our eye is, if we see the black and white color, we can only observe the shade of the gray, approximately 12 or 14 shades of gray we can observe, right? But if we see the things in color, then we can able to differentiate the things more precisely as compared to the grayscale image. So if we want to see anything in color, we need to go with the color combination or band combination. And band combination could be any of three bands, which could be open in red, green, or blue, right? So when these band combinations are open in red, green, or blue, then color, we can get an object or get an information or image which is a colorful images, right? So that we can object or get the a different sort of colorful response in a colored images of a particular object. Okay, come to the next slide. Okay, so color combination is basically nothing but a two type. One is the natural color composite and another one is the false color composite. Natural color composite is nothing but for example, combining a band, three bands in such a way that it appear as a natural color. For example, if we see with the naked eye, if we see the grass is green in color, then in image it should also appear in green in color. Right. If road is black in color or gray in color, it should also appear in a gray or black in color in the natural composite. This is called as a natural composite. It is a true color composite, right? It is a true color. That means whatever our eyes are seeing the color of a particular object, the same color would have appeared within the bands also. Okay. Now, so natural color composite, people don't use that natural composite too much. But they have particularly used the false color composite, which is lot many time asked in an interview or in a questions they have asked in an examination. Next slide. So false color composite is nothing but a giving color combination to a object which shows a false color or a different color. For example, if I give vegetation, we have for example, if I go over a vegetation land or a forest cover area, right? So within a forest cover area, we can have a grassland also, we can have a bushes also, we can have long trees also, different sort of the vegetation we can get, right? So how do I differentiate between the different sort of the objects or different vegetation land? So for that purpose, we can use the false color composite. That means not a single color, not a natural color is given to a particular object, but false color is given, right? And that false color is basically depend upon the maximum reflectance of a particular object. So if we see this thing particularly, we have a table which saying on the left hand side, we have the Landsat 7 ETM plus Landsat 7. Landsat 7 is the name of the satellite, is a commercial satellite provided by the NASA, right? Given by the NASA. And ETM plus is the sensor. ETM means enhanced thematic mapper is the sensor, right? And below that, we have written that 4, 3 and 2. These are the band number 4, band number 3 and band number 2. Band number 4 is the spectral wavelength region from, it is a range of the wavelength region from 0.77 micrometer to 0.89 micrometer. Similarly, band 3 has the wavelength region 6.3 to 0.67 and band 2 has the 0.51 to 0.60, right? If I want to see the color composite or the FCC of made from the Landsat ETM plus, then what I have to do, I have to open band number 4 in red, band number 3 in green and band number 2 in blue. Why? Because I have to see, if I want to see the things in color, then I have to open or see the spectra in the combination of red, green and blue. Mujhe agar koi cheez dekhni hai color mein, toh mujhe teen combination chahiye, red, green or blue. And I have to open my band combination 4 to red, 3 to green and 2 to blue, right? And if we open that particular image, the image would appear something like this. Go to the next slide. Right. So whatever red color you are seeing, all these red colors are belong, or shades of the red to pink are belong to the vegetation land. Right. Why vegetation red appear red? Because Landsat number 4, Landsat band number 4, which has the range of 0.77 meter to 0.9 meter. In this particular range, vegetation has shown the maximum reflectance. So maximum reflectance in band number 4, if we open it in red, as a red in color, maximum reflectance of a particular object in range 0.63 to 0.67. If it is there, if we show that in green color, it would appear in green color. If the maximum reflectance of a 0.51 to 0.6, it would appear as a blue color, right? For example, take an example of a glacier environment, the vegetation and the glacier environment, both the case. So if the the maximum response of a snow or a glacier, if we see that in a 0.63 to 0.67, right? And if we open that snow cover band number 3 in the green, then all the snow would appear as a green in color. Okay. If we have the maximum spectral response of water in 0.5 to 0.6 region, right? If we open that color or the water combination maximum reflectance in blue, then water would have appear as a blue in color. Okay, so this 4-3-2 combination is the standard FCC, standard false color composite of a Landsat image. Is that clear to everyone, or if you have any doubt, you can ask. Go to the slide back to one slide. Please go back to one slide. Yeah. Now, if you have any question, you can ask.
Hello, sir.
Hello, you can ask your question. Can ask your question.
Yes, sir. Sir, is the intensity of color defines the actual range in the band?
Yes, like intensity of color is also defined the type of object we have. For example, go to the next slide. Okay, if you see this particular image, this is the ASTER data. ASTER is a thermal emission radiometer. So this is the ASTER data. If you see that the slide closely, you can identify the shades of red, ranges from high red color to pinkish in color. Okay. You yes, can sir. Observe that. Okay, yes. You can observe the very, very dark red color or a very bloody color is there. And you can also that there is a pink color is also there. So you can identify the shades of the red is there. Okay. So what this shade of the red is defined. So what we have done, we have opened our near infrared region to the red region, red band, red in color. Okay. So what happened that vegetation, which has the maximum reflectance in near infrared region, all those vegetation are appear in a color of red, right? So wherever you can have the very bright color or very reddish color texture, you can say that, okay, this particular region is belong to the densely forested area. And wherever you have a shades of pink to white or whitish or pinkish in color or reddish pink in color, you can say that there is also a vegetation, but that vegetation could be your sparse vegetation. Right, that is not the area of dense vegetation. You can have little bit of bushes, jhaadiyan vagaira ho sakti hain, but there would be not be the canopy of a particular tree. Right, so wherever you have a paddy field, you have a canopy, you can have the bright red color, or wherever you have a bushes or shrubs, you can have the pinkish in color. So it depend upon the health of the vegetation. If the health of the vegetation is very good, it would appear as a red in color. If the health of the vegetation is not good, it would not appear as a red in color, it would appear as a pink color. Also take an example of water, right? In the northern side of the satellite image, you can see there is a patches of black in color, right? There is a river is going on and there is a patch of black color is there, bluish black color is there.
Yes, sir.
Right. So yes, these patches of black color is basically what it is. It is basically a reservoir over the Damodar River Valley. This is the Damodar River, and there is a river reservoir over the Damodar River Valley. So within the reservoir, we have a lot of water is there, right? And it is a clear water is there. So clear water, what happened that when the radiation has been, it is absorbed completely by a water content. So because it is completely absorbed by water content, it is appear as black in color. Kyunki amount of radiation kuch reflect hi nahi ho raha, sara gaya. So because of this absorption, what happened that the reservoir is basically appear as blackish or bluish black in color. If that reservoir is little bit of it is contaminated or it is filled up with a silt color, right? Or it has the lot many suspension material are present within there, then this bluish color, dark bluish or blackish bluish color is not there. It would be appear as a little bit of blue in color, right? Sky blue in color. So if you take the image of a Ganga river, for example, so in the active floodplain zone, you can see that there is a cover of sparse vegetation or cover of little bit of water is there. So that water, because of the presence of or amalgamation of because lot many times
excuse me, sir.
Interview, the hello? Question would be asked about that.
Hello?
Yes, you can. Yes.
By any chance, is there any case that we can distinguish or find out trace elements or like that something using this remote sensing applications?
No. We will come to that particular part. See, let's not talk about the trace element. If you are talking about the trace in respect of groundwater, let's not talk about it. We'll talk about the trace element or rare earth element composition within the rock. Or, okay, take an example of rare earth element in a rock. Is that this is more or less similar in the ground?
Yes,
okay.
It's about rocks only, not in water.
Okay. Rare earth element. We take the example of rare earth element in right. The content of rare Right, because that is why it is called as a rare, because it is not available in a quite in abundance. It is available in a rare format. Right. So what we have a hyperspectral mapping technique. Right. So what it do hyperspectral mapping technique? Go back to one slide. So hum, please go back to one slide. Yeah, okay. If you take the wavelength region, for example, it ranges from 0.6 to 0.8 or 0.77, right? So band combination from 2 to 4, only we have 0.6 to 0.8 region, wavelength region, we have only 3 bands in Landsat ETM, right? Hello.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So we have only 3 band
combination. Yes, sir. Yeah. Ranges
6 to 0.8. 0.6 se leke 8 ke beech mein aapke paas keval 3 band hi hai. What happened that if certain sensor provide you more than 220 bands or 220 channels between 0.6 to 0.8, right? For example, in Landsat case, what we have done, we have divided the 0.6 region to 0.8 region into 3 band combination or 3 bands or 3 channels. What if we divided the whole wavelength region, 0.6 wavelength region to 0.8 wavelength region into more than 220 wavelength region or wavelength or spectral channels? So what we are doing, we are increasing our spectral resolution, right? We are increasing our spectral content. So once the spectral content is enhanced, your ability to identify a particular object is become more. That means if two objects are very, very closely related to each other, but their spectra would definitely be different, then that minor change in the spectra can be detected within the more than 220 channels. That can be possible. Are you understanding what I'm saying?
Yes, sir, I got it.
Right. So based on that, you can identify the rare earth mineral. However, so far, no studies related to the remote sensing based on the detection of rare earth element using remote sensing has been determined or came to existence. But only recently, 2-3 years back, 3 papers were published on identification of the carbonatite using the remote sensing data. But that 2 are not from India, that 2 are from the US or some places. So only 3 papers we have recently seen that they have recognized they try to identify the pixels of carbonatite mineral from the hyperspectral data. They have done it, right? So it has possible, but the only thing is your content should be very much high, right? Or your rare earth element body should has been exposed to the more than 30 meter or 40 meter in dimension, right? Then only you can able to identify this thing. Otherwise, it would be very difficult. Moreover, you also need to have a speciality in that, because the spectral response of the rare earth elements is very, very close to each other. I think there is 15, 16 rare earth elements are there. So their spectral response is very, very closely related to each other. So you need a very, very close wavelength region channels to detect these minor observations. You can do it, but only limited, very, very limited studies have been introduced for the extraction of rare earth. Okay. And we will discuss we discuss about the hyperspectral remote sensing. We'll discuss about these things in detail.
Okay. Sure.
If there is any problem to anyone regarding the false color composite, you guys can ask. If there is any problem, because these kind of question would have been asked in your interview. We go in somewhere in interview, when I was in GSI, they asked me about FCC. So you can go ahead, maybe ask me. Okay, is there any question you can ask?
Hello, sir. I don't know which idea we can combine the 7 band from any 3 band from the 7 band to get any particular color of the any region.
Okay. Repeat your question, please.
From the 7 band, how can we see any 3 band color, 3 bands to get any color of any region?
You can need any band combination. It's up to you totally. Right. Landsat 7, for example, has the 7 band combination. You can combine, you can get any band combination. We are using for a standard FCC 432 combination. You can use 532 combination. There is absolutely no problem. You can open your band number 7 in red. You can open your band number 5 in green, band number 2 in blue. And that particular band combination is specifically used for the listology discrimination. Right. So you can use any band combination you like. The only thing you have to remind that when you have to open any, for example, you want to open any band combination in red color, then the maximum reflectance in that wavelength region only appear in red color. That you should remember that. Agar kisi ka agitation ka maximum reflectance near infrared region mein hota hai, to aapko vegetation red color mein hi dikhai dega agar aap usko red color mein kholo. Agar usko aap blue color mein khologe to wo blue dikhai dega. If you open that in green color, it would appear as a green color. That is the thing. You can make any band combination you would like, but you have to only think about that. Whatever you want to explore, whatever you want to extracting, that material or that thing should have the maximum reflectance in blue, green, or red.
So one last question.
Okay. Am I audible to everyone?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes, please.
So, in Landsat 7 ETM Plus, there is a range of values in which we decide that it will we will make it red, green, or blue. So, can we modify the range? Like, can we say like we can take 0.772 to 0.672 as red if we want to? Can we do that?
Repeat your question. Please repeat your question.
So, in like Landsat, in this data which you have in slide, can we modify the range according to our needs? Like, can we take like make two divisions? Like it has three divisions, like red, green, and blue. We can make red or blue.
No. That is the limitation. That is the limitation. If that would be possible, why everybody need to keep on distributing so many satellites? Right? You cannot change the or subdivide the particular wavelength region of a particular sensor. You cannot divide that. For example, if you have a band combination, take example of Landsat 7, band number 4 is ranges from 0.77 to 0.89. Okay. So if you want to divide into 0.75 to 0.78 to or divide that band number 4 into certain part, you cannot divide that. Right. So sensors are specifically designed for the particular wavelength region. If you want to do that, you can check it out in a different satellite sensor. For example, now these days, NASA is providing satellite, USGS is providing satellite called Sentinel-2B. Sentinel-2B is quite better than Landsat 7. Or even now these days, Landsat 8 is also there. But still, I believe that Sentinel-2 data is quite much good as compared to the Landsat 7. So if you want to see the things in a wider spectral range, then you have to go to the other sensor. You cannot divide a particular wavelength region into two or three parts. Only thing you can do, you can resample your data. Resample means you can see the things. If the some things are looks very blur in color, then you can just resample it to so that you can see the things in a better way. But you cannot divide the wavelength region into a certain wavelength or two or three part. That is the thing. That is our limitation of the remote sensing. If you want to do that, you can go back to other satellite data. Don't use Landsat. You go to the Sentinel data. You go to the NOAA IPUV HHR. Or you can go to the resource set data. You can go to the hyperspectral data. That is up to you. But you cannot divide the wavelength of a particular sensor into certain parts. Okay.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay, go to the next slide. Next. Okay, so resolution in remote sensing, it's a continuous topic. So I think in the next session tomorrow, we'll take that particular thing. Okay, so I think it's already over. If anybody has any question, you can ask. There is absolutely no problem, because if I take that particular topic resolution, it would also extend for approximately half an hour or more than half an hour. Okay, so if you have any question, you can ask, or we'll take this from this particular forward, this point forward, in the next session. Okay, anyone have any question they can ask up to so far?
Hello, sir. Sir, selective scattering and non-selective scattering difference?
Selective scattering is basically, see, we have a particle in the atmosphere, right? And the size of the particle, yes, is very, right? For example, your gaseous particle has a different size, your ashes of the particulate matter has a different size, your aerosol has a different size, your ionic particle has a different size, right? So selective, yes, scattering, sir, means it depends upon the size of a particle, right? Size of a particle could be larger, size of a particle could be shorter, right, in the dimension. And yes, the scattering, sir, is based on the size of a particle. Itna aapka incident hoga kisi particle pe aur kis direction mein reflect karega ya deflect hoga ya scatter karega, it depends upon the size of the particle. In case of the non-selective scattering, it doesn't depend upon the size of the particle, right? The size of the particle should be very, very, very large, right? Very large. And the wavelength region which has to be scatter, that means size is very large. So whatever wavelength radiation incident over it, it already deflected in every direction. So overall, all the radiation has been scattered by the non-selective scattering. That is selective and non-selective. Difference is non-selective and selective scattering. Okay. Any other question you can ask?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Sir, about panchromatic film and infrared film.
Puchhe, kya puchhe?
So, which special feature differentiate infrared film from the panchromatic?
Okay. Panchromatic data is nothing but it is just a
flight.
Right. It's, what we call it. We go to the, for example, outside and take the photograph, that is any photograph which is taken in the white light is called as a panchromatic, right? Which is, yes, ranges photograph taken in the region of 0.3 micrometer to 0.7 micrometer. But if we take the example of the infrared film, if we introduce the infrared film within the panchromatic data, what happened that, why infrared film is important? Now you know that infrared film is important because it shows the maximum reflectance of vegetation in that particular thing, region. Okay. So, yes, what it differentiates that is when you introduce the infrared region, you can observe the thing in color and vegetation would have appeared in a red color or in a tone of red, right? So, you can easily identify the fresh vegetation and the dead vegetation. The thing is why camouflage has been introduced. So, camouflage introduced isliye kiya tha because वो क्या करते थे कि मेडिकल या मिलिट्री फैसिलिटीज के ऊपर जो भी उनके टेंट्स वगैरह होते थे उसको वो क्या करते थे, बुशेस से छुपा देते थे, पेड़ पत्ती पौधे लगा के छुपा देते थे उसके ऊपर, राइट? सो अगर ओरिजिनल पेड़ या पौधा होगा तो दैट वुड हैव अपीयर एज अ रेड इन कलर, और इफ इट हैज बीन डेड, अगर वो डेड है या सूखी पत्ती है तो वो इट वुड हैव बीन अपीयर नॉट अपीयर इन अ रेड कलर, राइट? सो बेस्ड ऑन दैट दे एबल टू आइडेंटिफाई द पर्टिकुलर थिंग कि कहां पे टेंट्स वगैरह हैं या कहाँ पे देर मिलिट्री फैसिलिटीज और देयर और नॉट. सो बेस्ड ऑन दैट तो उस समय तक सिंस अप टू द वर्ल्ड वॉर टिल वर्ल्ड वॉर टू दे हैव यूज्ड दिस थिंग्स फॉर द मिलिट्री ऑपरेशन, स्ट्रिक्टली फॉर द मिलिट्री ऑपरेशन. लेटर ऑन आफ्टर द इंट्रोडक्शन ऑफ दिस कंप्यूटर द मैनुअल थिंग हैज बीन कन्वर्टेड इनटू द digital format, and we now interpret data in digital format, because after the United Nations, everybody or every country had decided that okay, we should not indulge into the war kind of thing, we just use the technology or the science for the humanity purposes. So what they have used earlier, before the World War II, they have quite used the remote sensing technique for the military surveillance, but later on they have for purposes of scientific, right, for monitoring of the resource, earth resources. Okay, any other question?
No sir, thank you.
Okay, so again I'm asking, if anyone has any question they can ask, or if you understand the things, try to revise it, or if you have any question, then come into tomorrow.
Sir.
Yeah. Yes.
Can it even detect the fossils, fossils, sir?
Fossils? No, you cannot detect the fossils, because your fossils is entrapped with sedimentary rocks. So over you can see only the sedimentary rock or the planar section you can view. You cannot more or less, as fossils are very much smaller in size. The yes. Minimum pixel size is approximately 10 meter by 10 meter, or the commercial data they are providing is available with the money, that has approximately 0.46 resolution. That means 46 centimeter is of one pixel. So even I believe your fossil is less than 0.46 or 46 centimeter, right? So you can't see that. Other thing is, if the large fossil is there and it is exposed over the surface, then you can recognize, but you need an expert eye for that.
Yes, thank you, sir. Yes.
Okay. Who was asking? Koi aur puch raha tha sawal.
Sir, actually there is a question from the Telegram group. Miss Astha Mishra has asked, where does India stands in the race of remote sensing?
Very, 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 our future is very, very bright, right? I think it is stand at second place or third in Western countries. NASA is the pioneer organization. They have the big amount of funding and everything is there. Now these days, European Space Agency, Canadian Remote Sensing Agency, they also came into existence. Apart from that, Russians, USSR earlier and Russian now, Japanese and these Chinas and Israeli, they are also competing in these now. After I think 2003 or 2008, I think India has launched a very, very big program that make us to compete or get us to the same platform with the NASA and European Space Agency. The problem only with us that we don't have that much finance, right? So that is why we use the orbit maneuvering technique and other technique. NASA has the big plans. They got lot of money, so they have used Falcon satellite, and jisko aap yahan se chhodenge and within the one shot it will reach to the Mars. We don't have that much money. So what we do, we use to use the orbit maneuvering technique. We use the gravitational forces of a particular orbit to reach the Mars. Take an example. For example, I take the example of a Chandrayaan, right? So Chandrayaan mission has the 13 sensor, and based on the 13 sensor, only six sites are from rest of the seven are from US or European Space Agency and Canadian Space Agency, right? So it was the collective response. If India doesn't stand among all these nations, then why would anybody come to India and collaborate with us, right? So I think that thing, or the level of India has been increases after the 2008 cryogenic engine technique. I think 2008 or 2003 the technique had came into existence that continuously or increases the efficiency of a payload, that means platform efficiency of payload and platforms, that has increased. That is why the missions, India has almost 100% success rate of for every mission after 2008. So we have a bright future. We stand, I think, second or third among the most of the developed nation. That only because we have that we doesn't have that much financial funding. That is the main reason, I think.
Hello. If someone has some question, they can ask right now.
If you are happy, you can ask right now. If you want to ask in the later session, you can ask later session. There is absolutely no problem from my side. You want to ask, I'll happy to give answer from my side.
Hello, sir.
Ji, bataiye.
In panchromatic film, the image was taken in range between 0.35 to 0.7.
Ji, right.
Then what is the range of infrared film?
Range of infrared. Infrared is a long wavelength region. It ranges from 0.9 micrometer to up to 100 micrometer. And it has been further divided into three regions. One is, which is called as a near infrared region, infrared, then near infrared region, then we have a shortwave infrared region, and then we have a thermal infrared region. So the range of the visible near infrared region is approximately 0.8 to 0.9, and then the near infrared region is approximately 0.9 to 1.1, and then shortwave infrared region is approximately 1.35 to 2.65 micrometer or 3 micrometer, and the beyond that, from 3 micrometer to 100 micrometer, we have a thermal infrared. Okay.
Sir, can you say again?
हाँ मैं ये बोल रहा हूँ कि शॉर्ट वेव इंफ्रारेड रीजन इज अ वेरी वेरी लार्ज रीजन सॉरी इंफ्रारेड रीजन इज अ वेरी वेरी लार्ज रीजन राइट इट इज फर्दर डिवाइडेड इनटू फोर पार्ट वन इज विजिबल नियर इंफ्रारेड रीजन शॉर्ट वेव इंफ्रारेड रीजन एंड थर्मल इंफ्रारेड रीजन सो विजिबल नियर इंफ्रारेड रीजन इज अप्रोक्सीमेटली रेंजेस फ्रॉम 0.8 to 0.9. I'm not confirmed. You can check it out on internet. Right. Then visible region is ranges from approximately 1 micrometer to 1.2 micrometer. Then your shortwave infrared ranges from approximately 0.5, 0.6 to 3 micrometer or 2.65 micrometer. And then we have a thermal infrared region, which ranges from 3 micrometer to 100 micrometer. Within that, your window is ranges from 8 micrometer to 14 micrometer. Okay.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Or koi question hai to puchhi.
Hello, sir.
Any other question you want? Yes, you can ask.
Hello. Am I audible? Hello, sir.
Yeah. Please ask your question. I am listening to you.
Sir, under what conditions we will use Viskroom and Piskroom radium?
Under what condition we use Viskroom and Pushroom sensors, right? That is your question?
Yes.
Okay. It depend upon the purposes actually, right? So people in earlier days, what they have used the Viskroom sensors, right? Whisking means whisking, anda fetna, that is what is called the whisking, right? So when we used to whisk an egg, what we have to do, we have our hand to show the oscillatory movement, right? To and fro movement is there, right? Similarly, in the Viskroom sensor, what we have a rotating mirror over there, and this mirror is rotated up to a 90 degree to 120 degree, right, over the surface of the earth. And it do the scanning kind of thing. So the scanning by the Viskroom mirror is perpendicular to the direction of the flight. Just direction of flight ud rahi hogi, a satellite ja raha hoga, us direction ke perpendicular wo oscillatory motion hoga, and that used to detect or scan Earth in that fashion, right? So people have used the whisk broom sensor earlier cases, right? Because when you use the whisk broom sensor to quantize the level, to get the response of the energy level is very, very much low, right? So low resolution data you can get. Now these days in everywhere, people are or the satellite makers are using these push broom sensor, right? So in case of the push broom sensor, what we have in both the cases, the things are very much similar. There is no difference between the thinking. You have a satellite direction and perpendicular to that, the scanning is possible, right? But the only thing is that difference is the scanning. In case of the push broom sensor, we have a, despite of the oscillatory mirror, what we have a linear scanning sensor, right? Which is made up of an array of the sensor. Array means line se ek sensor lage hote hain. So what they actually do, they scan the particular object in a linear fashion, which is parallel to the direction of the propagation of the satellite. Jis direction satellite ja raha hoga, usi direction mein line by line scan karte rehte hain. So what happened that in push broom sensor, what quantized energy is very much high, so that you can get a very good spectral response and a spatial response, right? So that image you can get in a form of a strip, ek lambi si patti ki tarike se aapko data milega. For example, you take an example of Hipparion data. Hipparion data is a strip format data, right? It is a hyperspectral data which come in a line. Usko aap dekhenge to ek lambi si patti ki tarah dikhai dega. We will show it later in our next session, right? Similarly, you can see the Chandrayaan data, moon mineralogical mapper Chandrayaan data. In the same thing is that that data is also available in a strip form. So that is the major difference between the push broom sensor, whisk broom sensor. Now these days, people are generally using push broom sensors, because in case of the mirror, there is a problem that when the satellite is rotating, this result in the distortion. Mirror has been rotated, or it do certain kind of thing, or certain oscillatory movement is there. Because of that, error has been generated. So now these days people are using this push broom sensor, which has the array of a linear array of a sensors, lines of sensor lagi hote hain, and that we, okay, I hope your answer is there.
Yes, thank you, sir.
If there are any other questions, you can ask, or you can go for your lunch.
Any other questions you can ask, or you can go for lunch. Or if you have any doubt or any question, please write it down and we will answer your query to in the next session. There is absolutely no problem.
Thank you, Raju sir, for such a wonderful session, for such an informative lecture on the remote sensing today. Hope you are little tired after giving such a long lecture. Thank you for being with us. So my announcement to every participant that now we are going to have a lunch break. So after the lunch break, that is sharply at 2:20 or 2:30 p.m. we shall start with Piyush Srivastava's gear up your research engine talk. So be right back on 2:30. Till then, thank you everyone.
One more thing, if time permitted, tomorrow or day after tomorrow, 10-15 minutes time will permit, then we will definitely talk about the emergence of ISRO. How India reached to this particular level, we'll definitely have a look at it. There is absolutely, it was a very interesting story, and we will listen to that. There is absolutely no problem. So in case you have any question, you can write it down. We will meet tomorrow and we will answer your query. Right. And thank you all the organizer, and they have wonderfully organized all these things, or all these lecture that we do with us. All right.
Thank you, sir. I repeat, Mr. Piyush Srivastava, lecturer will be from 2:30.
अभी तो एक platform बंद कर, बहुत ज़्यादा echo आ रहा तेरे आवाज़ के पीछे. हाँ, ठीक. हाँ. अभी कर दिया कर दिया कर दिया शुरू कर दिया कर दिया हाँ हेलो हाँ अतुल हाँ मैंने YouTube लाइव में लाइव चैट भी ऑन कर दिया है तो तू एक बार अनाउंसमेंट कर दे कि जिन जिन को क्वेश्चन है और जो YouTube से देख रहे हैं वो अपना लाइव चैट में क्वेश्चन लिख दे ठीक है ठीक ठीक चलेगा ओके ओके ठीक हेलो हाँ अरे शुरू हो गया क्या लेक्चर? हेलो सोम तेरा आवाज नहीं आ रहा है। हेलो हाँ हाँ लेक्चर शुरू हो गया क्या?
हाँ शुरू हो गया।
अरे पर आवाज नहीं आ रहा यार
सर का।
हाँ मेरे उसमें आवाज नहीं आ रहा है। रुक जा मैं ज्वाइन होके फिर से ये कर रहा हूँ। ठीक है
ठीक है कर
सकते। ओके हाँ हाँ इन कर दिया मुझे। हाँ ठीक है ठीक है। अभी पर आवाज़ क्यों नहीं आ रहा मेरे इसमें यार?
देख माइक ऑफ क्या होगा
चेक कर रहा हूँ चेक कर रहा हूँ।
as a foreign language. So this is helpful in all the institutions. For example, if you want to go to Europe, you want to go to America, the TOEFL score is valid everywhere. So it is better to have TOEFL score once than try all the institutions, and if you do not get institution in Europe, then you can try for GRE and you can go to America also. So, and then GATE is always important whether you stay in India or abroad. So, do focus on GATE because a lot of European universities are taking admissions on the basis of GATE. The project is available everywhere. I mean, in India, abroad, or whatever place you want, you can go for project, and there is no such requirement of TOEFL, GRE or anything else for project students because they are hired as an employee, so they do not require this. But this is possible that a lot of country have criteria to provide visa on the basis of TOEFL score. So in that case, even if you are going for project, you will have to require TOEFL. So from this particular slide, what I will suggest is to do focus on GATE and TOEFL if you are planning for research. So this will fit in all the criteria, whether you want to go abroad or you want to stay in country. And if you are good enough to secure good score in GATE, then you will be eligible for PMRF also. And PMRF itself provides money to go abroad. So in sandwich program, GATE, PMRF will be very good for you because then you can stay in country also, you can go abroad also. So do focus on GATE. This is the whole point in this. Okay. So, and NET is something which is very important if you want to stay in country for research, because few years back it was necessary to have you get JRF in order to become a professor or lecturer, but now it has been removed. But NET is something which is, I think, necessary because it's a national eligibility kind of test. So NET is also very important. I'll be focusing on NET specifically. So few steps what I'll talk now are something like what steps you should take when you want to start your research career. I mean, if you are in master's first year, then you are planning to start your journey for research from master's itself, and what all you can do. So the very first thing is you should focus on your dissertation, which is very important. That's a kind of home paper which is required everywhere, and you can put that as an evidence that you have this scientific temper, or you can continue your research in your whatever field you are going, because the project you had been given, you have worked very well on that. So dissertation is something on which you should focus for sure. It is not only for research actually. If you want to go to any PSUs also, they will ask about your dissertation, because that's something which proves about your temper, how you understood the concept and how you had taken the responsibilities given to you, some restricted paper, how you read about that paper. So the very first thing is your dissertation, and then start searching about the area in which you want to continue your PhD, and start talking with the professors, sending mails to some good professors or the writer of the book whom you have studied so far. So, and I mean, just start discussing about your problem in the subject, and that will also enhance the way you are writing your mails, because that becomes very important for continuing your research wherever you want, because in future you will have to collaborate with a lot of other people. So writing mails and literatures, these all are very combined to each other. So these all things start with your dissertation. So if you focus on your dissertation, you will have some idea that how you should represent your science, and then you can better write in your mail representing your science in very confined words. Then maybe somebody will understand your small messages and he will reply to you, then your contact will continuously increase, and then later on you can even stick with those contacts for your future plans. So I had also started writing mails in master's first semester, but in the starting days I was not able to get answer because maybe my mails were not that much mature. But as I started working in my dissertation field, I came to know what technical words I should use in my mail. I mean, how elaborate I should be and how confined I should be for some concept. So that also, you know, create some effective sentences in your mail. So and those mails become very important for starting of your contacts with the professor and that tempt professor to talk to you. If you are writing well, then they will understand that okay, he has understood the concept, I should reply to him. So after I think third semester, I was first time able to get response from any professor when I had worked a lot in my field. So you can understand how much effort you will have to put for getting responses from the professors abroad or maybe from our country itself. So focus on your dissertation, start reading a lot and then writing a lot, and then try to find the professor in your country, and then you can plan whether you want to go for full PhD program abroad, or you want to continue with sandwich program, or you want to stay in country completely. Okay, so on the basis of this decision, you can start talking or you can start searching for the possible funding. So these are some things which I told you, SERB, DART, Newton, Baba, and these are some kind of fundings you can go for if you want to go for sandwich. But if you want to stay in country, then GATE and NET is the most important thing. Okay. So today I'll be talking mostly about NET, how to crack NET and how to prepare for NET, what all strategies you should follow for NET, because I think GATE Karunanithi will be covering on 2 days later maybe. So I'll be focusing on NET and SPM, which I also have it. So hello.
Persistent sound is coming on packet.
What?
There is a persistent noise is coming continuously.
Okay, everyone has to mute the mic, including the admin, for the noise to get cancelled. Is it okay now?
Yes, sir, it is okay now. Okay, sir. Okay, you can proceed.
Hello.
Sir?
Am I audio?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay, sure. So, the name of the paper for NET JRF in our subject, I think somebody has switched on his microphone. Yeah, now okay. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Is it okay? I'm not getting. Somebody has
muted. You continue, sir.
You continue.
Okay. So the name of the paper is Earth, Atmospheric, Ocean, and Planetary Sciences. So this is for Earth Science students. So there used to be 3 seasons, the section A, B and C. So first I'll talk about section A. So section A used to be an aptitude section. So this section consists of 20 questions, out of which 15 you have to attend. I mean, anybody who attends more than 15, so first 15 will be only checked. After that there will not be any marks given to you. And each question consists of 2 marks. So first section contributes 30 marks. Okay, and this completely consists of aptitude part. And some logical question, reasoning question. You can think of Navodaya examination. The questions from Navodaya examination used to come in. So, and this is useful for GATE also. Because the first section of GATE used to be very similar to aptitude question of The only difference is NIT does not cover English part in the common aptitude section, but GATE covers English part also. Okay. So this 15 question used to be only aptitude or logical question. So this is something if you are able to solve some questions from your class 10th standard, you can surely secure 30 out of 30 marks. This is a bonus kind of section. I think we can secure 25 to 26 marks. So the second part used to be section B, which consists of 50 questions, out of which 35 one needs to attend, and this also consists of 2 marks. Each question is of 2 marks, and 70 marks is contributed from this section. So section A and section B consists total you can give you can get 100 marks from only 2 sections, and the whole paper used to be of 200 marks. So you can now think that section C might be of 100 marks completely.
So hum ek bar check kar YouTube live properly work kar raha hai ki nahi kar raha.
80 questions used to be in section C, 25 you need to attend, and each question consists of 4 marks. So it comprises 100 marks. So whole paper consists of 200 marks, in which only section C is of 100 marks, and you need to attend only 25 out of 80 questions. I mean, you have to. Somebody else had started saying. Yeah, so the C section contributes 100 marks, and 50% of marks you can get from section C only. So how does it look to you? It's you who can you can think that only if you secure our 100 full marks from section C and you cover all marks from section A, you can get 130 marks. It means at least under 10 or 15 rank. So what I think is, if you focus on section A and section C, you can secure a very good rank in NET very easily. Okay. So now how you should focus, and how, what should be your strategy to do this? Okay. So the strategy for section A, so what I personally suggest to all the aspirants is to practice the logical reasoning kind of questions from where you can, from anywhere, whatever source you get, you practice, or you practice the old year question paper, because there is no fixed syllabus for common aptitude section. There is no core questions from your geology, geophysics, or atmospheric science, or oceanic science, or planetary science. So this section is completely like, if somebody has good reasoning quality, he can surely secure 30 marks. So the only strategy is to practice previous question papers and aptitude questions from whatever exams you can get. But you have to make sure that you don't have to give a lot of time to this section, because this other section consists of 170 marks. Okay. So, and those two sections used to have all your core questions, core subject questions, questions from geology, geophysics, atmospheric science, oceanic science, planetary sciences, and all. So you have to give a lot of time to your section B and section C. So your core subjects are important for these 170 marks, and this 30 marks is like, if you are studying for section B and section C, your core subject, in between, if you get bored, you can, you know, take some book and start solving some aptitude section. That will refresh you also, and it will be beneficial for your future rank also. Okay. So section B is really something which I personally felt so hectic. I mean, you have to attend 35 questions out of 50, and these 35 does not I mean, these all 50 questions does not belong to only geology or geophysics. So, you will have to have some knowledge of atmospheric sciences, of oceanic sciences and planetary sciences, then only you will be able to reach out to 30 to 35 questions out of 50. Otherwise, if only geology and geophysics you cover, it is impossible to say, you know, solve 35 questions or attend 35 questions, because this paper is consist for all the students like earth sciences, atmospheric, oceanic, planetary sciences. So you have to be aware of this, because when you go to paper, sometime it happens a lot of question comes from other branches, not from geology, geophysics. So this becomes very tough for the geology, geophysics student if this happens in section B. But you don't have to lose your temper, because still you will be having section C, which consists of 100 marks. Okay. So for section B, what I'll suggest specifically, you focus on planetary sciences and climatology and your geology, because these three, if you are ready with these three subjects, then it becomes easy to attempt 35 questions, because then most of the syllabus will be covered, because the largest syllabus is from climate, planetary sciences and geology itself. Okay. So again, always be skeptical about section B, because at any time it can change its nature, because after every 6 months you check the way they have changed the paper pattern, section B has very irregular nature. Sometimes you will get 25 questions from geology, sometimes you will get 10 or 12 questions from geology. So this section is also very tricky part, so you will have to be very selective at what all parts you will be covering for the section B, and that will be completely based on your luck what part comes more in section B. I remember when I had given it on 17 December, it was too much at climatology, and I had prepared oceanic sciences. So for section B, the final suggestion will be to focus on your geology, and if you are from geophysics, focus on geophysics and some common section of geology also, because in section B, the question does not come from very core part of each subject, but it is very superficial kind of questions from all the branches. From planetary sciences also, they will ask some question on planetary motions. Not they will go in the deep, but very superficial question in section B, from ocean also, atmosphere also, and geology, geophysics. So focus on your geology, geophysics, and either more atmospheric science or oceanic science or climatology. So any two of atmosphere, ocean and climate you can choose. Okay, so section B is completely your choice based kind of preparation, and that will help in section C, which is the highest important section in the net GRF. You have to attempt 25 questions out of 80. I mean, you have to search a lot what all questions you are very sure, because there are 80 questions and you have to select 25 only. So usually what happens when we start section C, we start right from start, we start answering to the question, and we do not go for further, or we do not search for all those 80 questions, but people think it will take time, so they will start taking risk from very starting of their attempt. But you have to be very careful in section C. Do not answer directly. So what I'll suggest, go thoroughly to all the 80 questions and mark with some specific sign. For example, the question you think you are for sure, 100% sure you know the answer, then give a certain sign or ticket
in some way that you recognize that these are questions for which you are very sure. Then there used to be some question for which you have to think. I mean, you are not 100% sure, but if you will start thinking, you can answer. Then tick all those questions also. So maybe out of 80 questions, you figure out what all those questions are for which you are very sure. And if you are 100%, then only tick those questions. Because in this section, if you are going to gain 4 marks for each right, at the same time, the minus marking in this section used to be very high. So maybe it will ruin your all the effort from section A if you will mark it wrong. Okay, so be very specific in answering these questions. Because 1 by 3 part means almost you will lose 1.33 marks. So it is very close to marks in section A and B. Okay. So do not be in hurry in attempting section C, because if you will search 25 questions out of all 80 questions, I am sure you will get those at least 20 questions for which you will be sure. But yes, this section is really very interesting from all the perspective. You from geology also very good question used to come, from geophysics also, from atmospheric, from planetary, and from even from oceanic sciences. So what I'll suggest is do focus on geochemistry part if you are a student of geology, because in section C, 2 to 3 question at least they will ask from melting part of the geochemistry, or you can say igneous. So 2 to 3 question is for sure from relay melting or from batch melting.
हाँ तो
so do focus on that.
हाँ मैं ये बोल रहा था कि actually
and after that you can focus on plate tectonics, that is for sure. They will ask some questions one or two questions from plate tectonics. Then in physical geology, it is for sure that a question will come from dune, anti dune, or you can say rock failure. So 2 to 3 questions from there also it is for sure. And then it then sedimentary is very important in section C. So you can focus on sedimentary also. Then 2 to 3 questions, sedimentary environment, sedimentary structure.
And
12 question very easily you can get from these 3-4 subjects, 3-4 topics only from geology. Then you can look for few topics in geophysics also in order to create an option for you. If you don't get very good number of questions from geology out of 80 questions, then there are few fixed topics from which this section C used to have question always. For example, if you look at the gravity part of this geophysics, the very common question used to be what will be the depth some cylindrical shaped object if the gravity anomaly is of Gaussian. Object is, or they will give the gravity anomaly nature, and they will ask what is the shape of the object, but in so if a geology student, this is like a treat for them. If you just focus on 2 to 3 topics on geophysics, then you will be having at least 9 questions options in section C. So you are ready with 20 questions in section C. Then remaining 5 questions you can attempt from any part, like if you are focusing for your net on climatology or oceanography, any one of them. If you are focusing, then also you can attempt 5 questions. This is something, some strategy I am telling about, but I personally prefer full preparation for all these sections. But if you do not have time, then this could be an approach in exam. So but a very important thing is you have to search all the questions. You have to look for all 80 questions, then figure it out what all 25 questions you can look for. So, as I talked about geology, some specific topics in geology which is very important for GATE and for geophysics also, gravity and magnetic anomaly is very important. Similarly, in oceanography, there are few chapters I follow. I had followed Trujillo book for oceanography. So, in oceanography, the transport phenomena is one of the important topic from where they ask questions. And the other important topic is the biodiversity in ocean. What all kind of planktons exist, they are safe, and the environment they indicate. So these are few topics from where you can get a lot of questions in section C and section B both. So it is better you focus on oceanography if you do not have syllabus, because a lot of institutions, universities does not have oceanography or climatology in their syllabus. My own IIT Bombay had not you know, anything among these atmospheric ocean and planetary science in our syllabus. So I had specifically, I mean, I had studied oceanography just for NET. I had not studied this in my class because there were not any question or syllabus. This was not belong to our syllabus. So specifically you can focus on ocean or climate if that it does not belong to your syllabus. But if it is in your syllabus, then it's well and good. You can study those topics with your syllabus and you can go for NET. So this is all what I'll say for the strategy part of section A, B and C. Then comes if you secure very good rank. I mean, if you are securing rank like less than 8, then you will be called for an interview for Shyama Prasad Mukherjee scholarship. So this is possible that a student in master's first year will secure very good rank in it. This is possible. Or this is also possible, you have just completed your master and then you have secured very good rank. So in all the cases, they will call for Shyama Prasad Mukherjee scholarship. Okay. So in that case, how you will defend your interview? Because you have not started your research. You are in just first year of your master's and you have gone for SPM interview. So actually, this has happened. When I was called for interview, one student who had secured, I think, third rank, he was a master's first year student. So he had also came for interview and he got selected actually even after interview. There were a lot of senior scholars also who had come for SPM. They should have been given priority, but maybe that first year student had very good scientific temper, maybe he was ready for his future research. So this is possible. So do not think that you are in first year, then what is the need of thinking for SPM? So just clear the NET, no need to go for a higher rank. No, if you have a good rank and you are ready with your research proposal, and if you can defend that, you will surely get SPM also. So, why SPM is different from in what ways it is different from NET-JRF is the contingency and the scholarship amount. So SPM is quite high with respect to the only JRF scholarship, and the contingency is also too much. So this will certainly help in establishing a good lab, maybe some facilities in your lab, not a lab, but this will surely help in continuing your research. So, this is all what I wanted to say about NET, but I'm sure I'll be listening a lot of questions for which I'm ready, because this session should have been a two-way kind of discussion, because this is about a strategy and preparation of an exam. So, I'll hand over to the host and he can unmute to the participant. Queries I'll be answering now.
Okay, any participants who have any doubt, they can raise their hand and one by one they can ask their query or questions to Mr. Piyush Srivastava. Go for it, ask your questions.
Hello?
Yeah.
Sir, can you please suggest any climatology books for NET?
Yeah, so for climatology, I had found D.S. Lal, the best one, because
it had discussed in a very simple language the concepts. So you can go with DSLR for climatology.
Okay. So section B is mostly climatology and planetary science based.
So section B, actually you cannot predict, that's what I told you. I mean, section B, nature is completely different. So I do not agree that if you are talking about only research, then you should go for PhD. No, this is not true. Actually, even if you are going for job, you can have a research temper in you. And in order to get a certified temper, then only you should go for PhD. Okay? So, to have a certificate that you have that temper, you should go for NET or GATE. This is what I will suggest. So do not think that you want to go for industry, then no need to even look for research. So this is not good. So research is something called temper. This is not PhD only. Only a student who do PhD. Of you, but if you say that why should one go to research, then I'll surely say because it's a temper which says that you have understood the things what you are doing, and research is not very separate from industry. So industry itself has a research part in it. Okay, so, but if you ask for PhD, then surely you should at least look for some kind of a scholarship. So that is why these all things are required.
And what sort of challenges you are facing there as a PhD scholar?
See, what I'll say is I had few opportunities to go abroad, but I personally chose to stay in country because the facility I needed, I had that in IIT Bombay. So from my point of view, the only thing which is missing in country is the service. I mean, if something happens to the instrument, basically I am working on transmission electron microscope. So there are three transmission electron microscopes. Yeah. So there are three transmission electron microscopes. So from my side, it is okay till the time it is working. But if it is not working, then at what time it will be repaired is something which is very tough. So in country, in our country, in India, it is the... then this will not surely encourage any foreign authors to publish their paper in our journal, because it has very low impact factor. Then in our country it is very obvious to say that if foreigners are not submitting papers in our journal, then why should we? Because then they will start questioning that okay, the quality is very bad, maybe that is why. But yes, this is also true that there are few journals who are faking. They are not they are not doing ethical with their journals. So there is two aspects, which one, the one I talked about, the low impact factor cause and all. The second is the people who are starting journal with fake name of some foreign journal, that also create a problem in catching the thought of the good journal, to good researcher. So
Actually, I want to say something. Please, anyone who is asking any question, before asking your question, you should you should first tell your name, and then you will proceed for your question.
Excuse me, sir. Hello?
Yeah.
Sir, what was the name of the
Oceanography
book you stated? Can you name it again?
The author name is
Truzillo.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Hello, sir.
I wanted to ask about the next scholarship in Japan, if you know something about it.
Yes, next scholarship actually is... can apply for, I think this year the scholarship has gone now, you cannot apply this year. Next year you can again apply. This is also a sandwich kind of program for full PhD also. I mean, you can go for full PhD also with the same scholarship, or you can apply for some short internship with the same scholarship. So that require a very good research proposal and an acceptance letter from other end. I mean, the professor at the other end should send you an acceptance letter. This is required for next year scholarship.
Okay,
sir.
Hello, sir.
Okay, sir.
Hello, sir.
Hello, sir. Sir, what type of questions did I ask in PhD interview?
You what? What?
Sir, what type of questions generally asked in PhD interview?
In which interview?
PhD interview, sir.
No, I mean PhD interview means institute interview, PMRF interview, SPM interview. Because it is for scholarship, right? For PhD scholarship, there was some interview. And for admission in IIT Bombay, the question which was asked was on completely based on my dissertation. So they had asked about my dissertation and the area in which I wanted to continue my PhD.
Sir, how
did
you...
Hello, sir. I think several questions have been asked continuously. I mean, I'm not actually getting who is asking, because two, three people have asked.
Hello, sir.
Together. Yes. Who is that?
Hello, sir. Can I ask, sir? Hello, sir. I am Indira.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Sir, I am in MSc second year, and I have appeared net for last two times, and I have secured, first time I have secured 75 and second time I got 84. But I personally think that I am a bit poor in section C.
Okay.
Like I got 25 to 30 marks just in section C. So what can I do to improve in C section? Because C section is the most important section and I really want to improve.
Yeah, so I earlier said that section C itself consists of 100 marks, right? So you have to be very selective about 25 questions out of 80 questions. So there could be two reasons why you could not secure good. Maybe because you were not able to find 25 questions out of 80, or maybe you started picking questions from starting and you did not see the whole question, whole 80 questions. So the first suggestion will be, if you are in examination, look at all the 80 questions and then decide what all question you are for sure and what all question you have to think for once or twice. This is something which you have to do in examination. And before examination, as I said, prepare your core subject. I mean, if you are in geology, then study completely geology and few chapters in geophysics, for example, gravity and magnetic anomaly, and any one part, I mean either climatology or oceanography, if you do not have these in your syllabus. But if you have that in your syllabus, so you can revise all those things and then go and find, then search all 25 questions which are very you are very sure for. Okay, so this is what I will again suggest for.
Thank you, sir.
So can I ask? Sir, my name is Shayo. I want to ask if the hierarchy of the rank plays a factor in the selection. Like, for example, two students, one of whom has got GRF 25, another one has got GRF 35. Both of them are competing for a single seat under a single professor. Now, will the professor be bound to select the one with the higher rank? Or is it some kind of
I got your point. So, if somebody has cleared NET, then there is no preference to higher rank, okay? So everybody is same. I mean, everybody, whoever has qualified will get equal amount of scholarship and all. So professor doesn't look for the rank in the gate or NET. So they will look for your knowledge in that subject during PhD or before selecting PhD, because it's all about your understanding of the subject in which you are going to take admission in for research. Okay? So I have never even seen that any professor is asking about the NET rank.
Hello, sir.
Yeah,
I have it out. Like, my name is Ruby Kumari Prasad, and I had a question.
Can you just tell me what are the scopes after I complete my research? See, if you have done your PhD in See, this again depends on in what area you have done. So, if you are PhD, you have done your PhD in very applied branch, for example, groundwater modeling or contaminant release and all. So, you can start your own venture. You can start your own startup on the for consultancy kind of business. This is one option. The other thing is shortly after PhD, you can go for lecturership or professorship. And the other more options are R&D sectors in different companies. In PSUs, you can go for research and development part. So I think after PhD also, your opportunities always increases. Because if you are a master's student, you can only go for PSUs and all. But after PhD, you are expert in some subject. So you can go for even your own venture, you can go for PhDs, you can go for even professorship in academics. So especially there is increment in the opportunities after PhD.
Thank you, sir.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Hello. Sir, is there any sir, after qualifying gate, what are the sir, opportunity we get?
So after GATE, you can go for BSU, you can go for PhD in country, you can go for PhD abroad also.
Okay, sir. Sir, after qualifying GATE, any job opportunities?
Yeah, PSUs are there. PSU are the job provider for GATE scholars.
Sir, after qualifying GATE, any... Hello, sir. After that, any interview, personal interview on that or basis of rank?
No, there will be personal interview, like... BARC will organize its own interview, All India will organize its own interview, ONGC will organize its own interview.
Okay, sir, thank you.
Hello, sir. First of all, thank you. You are an inspiration to us. So, actually, my question is a little bit different from the preparation strategy. I think why you just left AMD, as you have scored a good mark in AMD interview too? ONGC is fine, everyone is not interested in going to ONGC, but why you left AMD? That means what excites you more to go into the research field? And if you want to share your topic of research, that means, of course, it's exciting, I think. If you want to ignore this particular last topic,
yeah, I'll talk about that. So for me, the most important part was freedom for research. So I had earlier thought that I'll get an opportunity to go for PhD in AMD also, because they used to give an opportunity to go for PhD from Homi Jahangir Bhabha Institute. So there was an option, but then I came to know when I went for the interview, and then I came to know after talking to a few of my seniors, then the area is quite specific field. I mean, if you are going for AMD, then you will have to do PhD in something which is beneficial for them. And you have to do PhD with some atomic mineral kind of thing. So I'm not interested in that. I wanted to do my PhD in something which had, you know, caught me for PhD. So my field is basically, it's quite applied field. So I'm working on nanomineralogical features of the clay and all. So this is completely applied. This is very new in country. So my area. Yeah. What?
Means instrument based. That means applied.
I am working on transmission in electron microscope. No, it's hardcore crystallography and mineralogy based.
How you choose this? Means how you came to know about this particular type of research field?
See, while reading, you will surely come to know the different branches. Actually, I was aware of this branch from MSc first semester, because I had a lot of interest in physics. So I used to read a lot of books in physics. Then I later on, means with time, I found that these are some branch in which our science students should go, and maybe we can figure out. In geology, we see processes at million years of scale, and the deposit used to be a few centimeters. So if you think the process might have happened at few nanometers every day, see, because the result is in few centimeters or few meters in millions of the year, means every day the processes are happening at nanoscale. I mean, the real thing is happening at nanoscale. Okay, we are looking at very average kind of result. So maybe the approach we are having right today will completely change tomorrow, because the processes which are really happening, nobody has had addressed that process. So this is something, I mean, the interest in surface science was something which had brought for this.
Okay, thank you sir for sharing your strategy. It was incredible. Yeah.
So, any other question?
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
My name is Kavita Sahu. Actually, sir, the math syllabus is runs into pages. It is very vast, sir. So, how would you manage to cover each and every topic which is mentioned in syllabus, sir?
That is why I told you ki, you don't have to cover everything. You have to be very selective for few parts. See, anyway, if you are a student of geology, you will have to cover all the geology. There is no doubt, for because you will have to give a lot of other exam also. So
yes.
Apart from geology, you focus on few topics of the other subjects. Okay, from geophysics, few topics you have to study. From climatology, few topics which are very important and very applicable for present day scenario. So you have to figure out those topics. Like I told you, in oceanography, transport mechanism and biodiversity, these are few topics which are very important for today problems also, and for net exam also. So you have to figure it out what all these specific topics which you should cover and which are covering very good marks in the exam. Okay, so this is what is called the strategy for examination. So without a strategy, if you're going, then I'm sure you will not be able to cover all the part of the syllabus. Okay.
And so can I go with GSI and NET exam together? Can I prepare both the exams? Can I prepare for both the exams together?
Yeah, so if you talk about GATE, then GATE is highly specific for geology, geophysics. It does not cover any question from oceanography or climate or any other branch. Okay. So I cannot say that if you want to prepare both together then it is tough. I cannot say this, but yes, if you are covering geology part and geophysics part in proper manner, then you are ready for both the exams. Okay, so for GATE you will have to just look few more topics which is not required in NET. So be very, very, you know, very specific for at least your core subject. Be prepared for your core subject. This will be the only thing which will come in both the examinations.
Thank you, sir.
I cannot hear. Can you speak again? Who is this? You are not audible actually.
Hello? Am I audible?
Yes. Yeah, ask your question.
Tell something about how to prepare for the numerical type question with GATE. Sometimes we did not find the formula which we applied. When we see the formula, it is very easy, but we did not go through one at a time about this topic or formula. The numerical type question which come on GATE.
Yeah, so for numerical in part in earth sciences, like since 2015, this numerical kind of thing is intruding in all the examination for earth sciences. So what used to be my suggestion is, like, while reading your books, wherever you see numbers, wherever you see some kind of graphs, just stop there and spend 5 to 10 minutes in those graphs, in those formulas, in those numbers. Even if it's a number, you stop there and think of some situation in which you can create some numericals on the basis of those numbers. So this is really something we should accept now, that GATE is asking question wherever you can see number. For example, in 2018 they had asked numericals on these planar features and crystallography. They had made that in N80 section. So if you somebody is studying this crystallography, he should focus in numerical perspective. I mean, you stay and think and create some question from yourself, and then you will be ready for the numerical part of those questions, numerical part of those topics. So this is clear cut indication that wherever you see number, wherever you see a graph, this is the area of interest for numerical. So for now, there is no such books, there is no such material, so you'll have to do it by yourself. So how I did was this only. I mean, I used to focus in those areas where I had seen even a trace of numerics. So I used to focus there, and I used to give some time and prepare my own questions. Then I used to practice those questions. This is how this numerical part I prepared.
Thank you, sir. One more question. Which book you go for, economic geology or old geology? What kind of
material? I had preferred two books. So in graduation I had studied a Batman book, and then post graduation I followed Lawrence and Robbs. So these are two books which I will suggest everybody, because these are very good books. You can understand all the basic concepts of this economic geology. So Laurent and Robbs and Batman. But for India specific posits, you should follow some Indian books. Who is
that? Hello sir. Any book related to geochemistry?
Geochemistry, Rawlinson.
Sir, speak again.
Rawlinson, Rawlinson.
Yeah. Okay, sir, thank you.
Hello. Sir, I'm Soham. Can you please brief me which is more advantageous for doing research? Is it through GATE or through NET?
See, I suggest GATE, because I know each and every student does not have very good economic background. So GATE is something which provides you scholarship on regular time basis. So on a fixed date, at least you will get your scholarship. Otherwise, there is no difference. The only difference is the regularity of the scholarship. So in NET and JRF, people used to think more about their money, because they do not get a scholarship for 3 to 4 months, and there are a lot of work used to get pending, They used to put on works in pending, and that creates a pressure on them. But in GATE scholarship, at least there is no pressure like this. So better go for the GATE scholarship. Because so maybe it will take 1 or 2 more years to reform.
Can I be able to appear the interview through GATE in SPM scholarship?
No. SPM is specifically for JRF.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, so I have shared my email ID. So if any further queries you all have, then I'm sure I'll be writing back to you all. So I think now we can finish it here. So and I'll request all the participants, if you have any question, you write back to me. You mail me, I'll surely respond to
you. Yes, sir.
Thank you, sir.
So, can we finish it now? Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. We
thanks,
do.
Thanks, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. So the email ID will be provided in the Telegram group to all the participants. You can have the email ID of Mr. Piyush Srivastava, sir, and you can ask your queries or questions there.
Thank you all participants for your patience and discipline. Today we end the session, and from tomorrow we can continue with our geomorphology class. Thank you. Now you can leave.
Every participants are suggested they can also put their queries in the Telegram group or in the YouTube live chat. These both things are also open for your queries. You can also put your questions there also. We will put each and every participant questions, and you can also raise your hand and voice here also in this platform. Now thank you for your participation, and you can leave this platform now. We are waiting for you for the next day program or lectures. Thank you. Thank you.